The Fan.
WIBC HD2 W298BB. WIBC HD3 W228CX. Indianapolis.
It's Kevin and Querry.
I throw, you catch. It's not that hard, okay? All right, get the out of here.
I'm going to talk a lot about drills and fundamentals.
Watch it.
On 93.5.
Watch it.
And 107.5.
Boom, baby.
The Fan.
So one of the few mornings where I get up early enough to actually shower, make myself presentable, didn't shave. I've got to go and do, I've got to speak somewhere from basically 10:45 till 3 o'clock today. So I thought I'd look presentable.
Jeez,
and I come in.
4 hour speaking engagement?
Oh, yeah.
Man,
and
pray for those people.
It's not all one group. Several groups throughout. And then I come in and the camera doesn't work. So nobody can see how sexy I look today.
See, I think what happened was you stripped down yesterday in the segment. And like, right.
It was the strut.
Plug.
It was the strut
pull
shirt.
The plug.
The camera doesn't work from 7 to 10, but then magically 10:01, it pops right back.
Listen,
on.
Listen, Kevin bought me the shirt yesterday that says, and I can't remember exactly how it said it, but it was the strut. It was the peacock shirt.
Strut of destiny or something like that?
Yeah, and so I've been strutting ever since, man. I was walking around yesterday like John Travolta.
You do have a lot of cool, like, college-centric t-shirts, or just maybe old-school t-shirts.
Well, I appreciate that. I mean, it's one of the things I like, right? Like, when I go to a school or I go to a campus, I'm like, oh, I got to buy a shirt.
This is one of your more vanilla days, clothing-wise.
Well, I've got to go speak.
Yeah.
I didn't want to show up at North Central High School rocking some Arkansas Razorbacks 1990 shirt, you know what I mean?
Are you saying the senior class doesn't have a lot of peacock kids going there?
That probably now, right? Hey, good morning to you. My name is Jake Querry. That's the voice of Kevin Bowen. It is Kevin and Querry here on 93.5, 107.5. The Fan, a lot to talk about, including Jim Irsay's comments. Anytime Jim Irsay speaks, people shall listen. By the way, Mike DeCourcy going to join us to talk college basketball just about 5 minutes from now to start things off. But, Kevin, one thing I thought was interesting yesterday in the NFL owners' meetings, Jim Irsay spoke, and he clarified his comments about all chips in.
Right.
And I was surprised that needed clarification. He was like, hey, listen, I'm not necessarily talking about from a money standpoint, but just a mantra, an attitude, a mindset, a commitment. That wasn't self-explanatory to people?
Well, I think to a lot of people, you hear all chips in and you immediately think monetary. I just think that's a given with how that phrase is worded. Especially because Irsay is a guy that hasn't been afraid to, you know, shy away from talking about trade winds are blowing or whatever his comments were. Back around Vontae Davis, Trent Richardson, etc. I did think his explanation of that, he hinted at potentially another defensive free agent signing that will play some audio as well a little bit later. And Jake, I am once again reminded that Jim Irsay absolutely can't stand Carson Wentz, because I don't know if I've ever seen or heard an NFL owner talk about a departing player in the light that Jim Irsay's talked about Carson Wentz. So we'll certainly get to all of that.
And what do you think, I mean, I know that we're going to get further into this, but what do you attribute that to?
I wish I had more clarity on that. It's certainly deeper than the vaccine. Has to be deeper than, I mean, you know, he used a phrase like, you know, oh my God, it became clear and obvious that we had to move on. Like, Jake.
I think other players went to, and I know that people think, listen, I try my hardest, Kevin. And folks, I hope you understand this. I listen to radio. I watch television. And I, like anybody else, tire of hearing other people tell me how smart they are or how they know more than anybody else. It's really tired in 2022. However, in the case of Carson Wentz, there were those that when people who covered the team were saying that his teammates just kind of looked side-eyed at him, that was a narrative we were making up and that there were photos to prove otherwise. I'm telling you, I think there are players that went to the coaching staff and said, it just isn't going to work with him.
I think the embellishment, though, has grown a bit too much, to be honest with you. It almost sounds like your uncle or your grandpa at a holiday telling the story for the 32nd time.
Yeah, that's fair.
And all of a sudden, the story sounds a whole lot more embellished than it did 5 years ago. It really seems like it's growing there. So we'll get into that. Irsay mentioned that the Colts were, I don't know, in talks for potentially trading a couple of first-round picks for a young quarterback. I'm curious Jake's thoughts on who that would be. Tarik Glenn going in the Ring of Honor. That was announced by Irsay as well yesterday. So a whole lot to get to on the Jim Irsay front. Joel Erickson, who's been at the league meetings, he is going to join us at 9 o'clock. But right now, 3 minutes for Mike DeCourcy, currently making his way through, I believe, TSA.
Yeah, that's probably why he
really
needs 3 minutes.
New Orleans bound for Mike DeCourcy. You know, we don't have many guests at 7 a.m., Jake. I'm trying to think, was Ryan Kelly the only one?
Yeah, Ryan Kelly was on his way driving to the complex, right?
He was prompt. He was 6:58 calling.
I remember, Kevin, this is, again, I'm going to preface with, this is unfair of me, admittedly. But during the bye week, the Colts had a practice, I want to say it was same day. But after their practice, heading into the bye week, and I get it. I mean, I'm a kid who, on spring break, when I was a kid, on that Friday, my parents called me in sick to school so that we could get an early jump on driving to Florida. I get it. So this is totally hypocritical of me, totally unfair of me. But I remember, I think it was the day the bye week started, like 3 hours after the final practice, Carson Wentz posted a photo of himself hunting. And that's fine. He has every right to do that. There was a part of me that was like, dude, you're the quarterback, though. Like, you should be the last one to leave the building until everybody else is done with their workouts. Or if Michael Strawn wants to go out and throw the ball around for a little bit in the afternoon, late afternoon before the bye week, I know this is totally unfair of me. I'm not a professional athlete. I'm assuming it's mentally exhausting, and that getaway time is critically important. But it just seemed to me like it had this, and this was before we even started getting rumblings, but it just kind of felt like, whoa, like the first chance this guy had to just go do his own thing, he went and did his own thing. And it just felt odd to me.
Yeah, I don't question his work ethic. I have no issue.
I don't know about work ethic as much as, like his, when he's in the building, it's probably good, but like just the overall... Like yesterday, Jacob Tammy said about Matt Ryan, there's no question that you are going to get a guy that is, every time he walks in the door, is going to be 100% fully prepared to play. There was just something about him that gave me pause that was the case.
Yeah, I think a stubbornness, a defiance of coaching, potentially. I think those are fair statements. Again, work ethic and the time he put in necessarily, I don't question that from him. But again, some of these Irsay comments. Woo! Woo! Tarik Glenn in the Ring of Honor. Didn't know Tarik super well.
Great guy.
I assume that one makes a lot of sense to you.
Oh, absolutely. And I think Tarik Glenn, you know, I'm not going to obviously take away from anybody that's in the Ring of Honor. He is more deserving than a couple that are already in there. Great player. Solid. You know, offensive lineman. I've always said offensive linemen are the kind of players that if you're not hearing their name a lot, it means they're really damn good at what they do. And yeah, he had a lot of false starts, but you know what? That's because for as big as he was, he did have a quick first step. But he protected Peyton Manning for a very, very long time. He was a security blanket on the offensive line. Great guy. I think a good leader and anchor for that line. And, you know, he's the reason that guys like Jake Scott, Ryan Lilja, who were really good players, Rick DeMoling, were able to be plugged in and out in the versatility of that offensive line because you were stable on the left-hand side. Joining us now to start off the show on the Payless Cigars Hotline, he is, of course, with Sporting News as well as Big Ten Network. He is the dean, as I always say, of college basketball writers, Mike DeCourcy, on his way to the Big Easy. For Mike, let's be real. It's a Final Four that's fascinating to me because people like myself look at it and go, gosh, it almost feels like an anticlimactic one. And then I think, but hell, the balance of it. I mean, any of these four teams, you look at and you could sell me on, I think it actually has the potential to unfold with some really, really good games.
Well, if I could sell you on Villanova after they lose one of their four best players to an Achilles injury, then that would make me like a hell of a salesman, I think. I just can't buy them now. I wouldn't have bought them coming in at full strength, but unfortunately, they're not even there. I mean, Justin Moore was an enormous part of what they do. Brian Antoine, who's likely his replacement, was a five-star guy coming out of high school, big-time player, but he's had a career filled with injuries. So I don't know whether he's never really had a breakout game, and now you're asking him to do that on the biggest stage in the sport.
I think the world of Jay Wright, Mike, and you're right. I mean, I get it. But, I think when I look at, and nothing against Bill Self and the Jayhawks, but who are obviously, very talented. If there's a coach in college basketball that could offset some things with adjustments, I do love Jay Wright.
Yeah, the one thing I will say that's in his favor, and it's not in the game's favor, is that I don't know that it was necessarily him or Villanova that forced the South Regional Final to be the way it was, but we got a real problem in the sport that needs to be addressed. The officiating, it's not a question of it being bad. It's a question of it being wrong. We're seeing scores go back down south again in the way that we did in 2013 that led John Adams and the Rules Committee to change the way the game was being officiated so that we had freedom of movement. Freedom of movement is gone again. We had the lowest scores in the regional finals in decades, and it's been trending that way all through the second half of the season. We at one point had 25 or so teams averaging 80 points a game. By the time we got to the end of the year, it was in single digits. That's something that he could take advantage of. If the game is allowed to be overly physical, I'm not saying that Kansas would necessarily be overwhelmed by that, but it would give Villanova a chance to stay in a game in which it's physically not as it's physically a shade overmatched because of the injuries.
Mike, officiating certainly has been a polarizing topic all season long, but how much Villanova-Houston related do you just chalk that up to? I mean, a Houston team that was, what, 1 of 20 from 3? And Villanova's facing, one of the better defenses out there. Sure, do they toe the line with the physical nature? Yes, but, to me, a lot of that was just both teams, especially Houston, got some open looks. They just couldn't throw it in the ocean.
I don't buy that. Having watched Bob Huggins' defenses at Cincinnati in person for four seasons as I covered them, that's what they do to you. When you're allowed to be that physical, you can't throw it in the ocean because your arms are tied. One of the big reasons Houston was able to get to the Elite Eight was because it was able to play that way. It was the only way they could play and be able to be as successful as they were. They were under-talented because they had so many injuries, somewhat similar to Villanova now. And so they committed to playing a certain style, and it worked in the tournament. And in part because the tournament officiating has been ineffective. It's been improper. I don't know what the exact right word is, but it's not the way basketball should be played. And so when Houston played in games like their Memphis games, where they were a little bit more free flowing, they weren't able to win those games. But they got into the tournament. Oh yeah, you want to foul? Go ahead, we'll let you. And all of a sudden, they're in the Elite Eight.
He's Mike DeCourcy from the Sporting News, again Big Ten Network, and he is off to New Orleans for the Final Four on this Wednesday morning. Given what you said about Villanova, the injury to Justin Moore, are you expecting a Kansas-Duke national title game on Monday?
That's my expectation, yes. Obviously, all four teams there could maybe win one game, but I think only Kansas and Duke can win two. So I would be really stunned if in a field, in this particular quartet, it were anyone other than those two. In the end, for decades, since Indiana listeners will appreciate this, it's been since 1987 that we have had a national champion that did not have a first-round pick, a subsequent first-round pick, whether it was that year or the year later, every single time since 1987. That's a pretty long history. That's basically my entire history of covering the Final Four. And so usually it's a Danny Manning or someone like that, or a Christian Laettner or Grant Hill. Sometimes it's a Josh Hart who goes 26th or whatever. But you have to have those guys. I don't think they're at Villanova, and I don't think they're at Carolina.
Mike, when you look at the job, Mike DeCourcy is our guest, that Hubert Davis has done this year in Carolina, getting hot at the right time. You know, that's a blue blood program, and they handed it over to one of their own, which I applaud. And then I thought about it, and I thought, you know, we've seen other times where coaches in the first year have kind of carried over what was set in stone, and then water kind of found its level. That's not to say that's going to happen with Davis. But have you seen body of work this year to say that this is, in fact, his thumbprint that is on this team and the run they're making?
Yeah, remember, I mean, it wasn't like he was taking over Carolina at its peak. I mean, they had gone 14-19 in the pandemic year. When the tournament went away, they were going away anyway. They were going to have an empty March regardless that year. And then last year, they were an 8 seed that lost easily in the first round to Wisconsin. So he wasn't taking over the program at a peak. There were two things, really. One is keeping the guys engaged when they were really struggling. I mean, they lost to Pitt at home by 9 points. Pitt did not win another game. That was in mid-February. Pitt did not win another game the rest of the year, but they beat a Final Four team on their own home court. That was a bad day for the Tar Heels. And then two and a half weeks later, they're winning at Cameron on Mike Krzyzewski's big night. So keeping them engaged, keeping them believing was a big part of it. And then the switch at point guard from from Caleb Love to R.J. Davis, changing their responsibilities so that R.J. became the primary ball handler. And that took great advantage of his terrific ability to get into the defense. And that's what won the Duke game. Him getting into the lane, kicking out, lobbing over the top, all those sorts of different plays that become possible when you're able to penetrate the lane. That's what turned around that game, and that's what's turned around their season.
He's Mike DeCourcy from Sporting News and with us here on the Payless Liquors Hotline. Mike, I don't know if you go back to your earlier point for a little bit of reasoning on this, but the Big Ten Conference and the continued lack of deep tournament runs, what do you point to for that?
Well, I think there was somewhat of a misunderstanding about this Big Ten this year. It was not the best league. First of all, anybody that said that was errant. It was never the best league. There wasn't any evidence to say they were the best league. What they had was the best set of individual players. I mean, there was an All-American at Purdue. There was an All-American at Illinois and one at Ohio State and one at Iowa, et cetera. And that was a unique situation relative to the rest of the country, that they had so many individual stars. But there wasn't enough support for a lot of those players. Johnny Davis at Wisconsin, by the end of the year, it was just guard him, don't worry about anybody else, and it worked. And part of it was Kofi's fault for not being able to throw out of the post enough. But guard him, let those other guys open, we'll win, and they did. And that became the way that you played a Big Ten team. They did not have a single team on the top two lines, which meant that they were not scheduled, so to speak, to have anybody in the Elite Eight, which they didn't. So they didn't underperform as badly as the Big Ten's detractors want to say. However, the Purdue episode stands as a significant mark against at least Purdue and maybe the league if you want to carry it that far. You can't lose that game. And they missed at the beginning. Their approach as a group to that game was wrong. Carolina had it exactly right. We're way better than these guys. It's a cute story, but we're way better than these guys. We go out, we show it early, they're going to go away. And that's what Carolina did. There was nothing necessarily technically different. It was just, we're way better than them. We play like it, and it'll be over. And that's what Purdue didn't do. In those first 5 to 7 minutes, they let it be a game. And St. Peter said, well, if we can beat Kentucky, we can certainly beat these guys. Let's go do it. And by that time, Purdue started to see, oh, my goodness, we're going to lose this game too, just like Kentucky. And the mentality of that, the psychology of the tournament, weighs against you if you don't do what Carolina did.
Mike, in your opinion, and I appreciate your time before we board here for your flight, in your opinion, bigger question marks heading into the offseason, Indiana or Purdue?
Oh, I think probably Indiana at this point, because you probably lose Trace, and he was such an important part of what you did. So I think that there, it's probably more there. I don't know exactly what's going to happen with Zach Edey at Purdue. Obviously, you're going to lose Jaden Ivey, but you've still got a lot of talent in that program, and some young players like Trey Kaufman that didn't even play this year that can be difference makers. And Caleb Burst, another player that I think can be very good there. So I think there's still a lot of talent at Purdue. The idea that because they lost that game that Purdue is now fated to never make the Final Four or whatever, I mean, they were one free throw away a couple of years ago in a year when it wasn't expected. I don't have any reason to believe that they can't get back to that level.
Mike, enjoy the gumbo, safe travels, and hopefully we can catch up with you next week to recap everything down there.
Thanks, guys. Always a pleasure.
That's Mike DeCourcy right there, off to New Orleans for the Final Four. Again, Kansas-Villanova, 6:09 on Saturday, and then Duke and Carolina to follow. Jake, yesterday the Sports Business Journal came out with the top local markets, TV rating-wise, for March Madness so far. Indianapolis, number one.
Was it number one? I would guess, let me think here. I would guess Charlotte, number one.
Indy, followed very closely by Louisville, then Kansas City, and to your Charlotte point, I guess a little bit, Greensboro, Winston-Salem, kind of crossed into one, and Dayton.
Dayton is, every time they do these, literally it's like, TV ratings have come out for the PBA Bowling Championships. Fifth is Dayton. Like, the people in Dayton just sit around watching sports all the time.
I mean, they obviously have a tie early on in the tournament, but still, I do feel like I see them a whole
lot.
The
Indy 500 Dayton is like the third highest market every year.
Yeah.
Every year. By the way, give me a year off the top of your head from 1988 to current.
2002.
2002, the national champion that year was Maryland, right? First round pick would have been Juan Dixon, is that right? Or no, Chris Wilcox, right?
Oh, gosh, they had a lot of balance.
Yeah.
Was Steve Blake a first rounder? Was he on that team?
I think he was probably a second rounder, right? Dixon might have been.
Lonnie Baxter.
Lonnie Baxter, yeah. They had some good players.
So he said the national champion in every year since 89 has had at least.
87.
87. So the 87. One first round pick?
I can tell you right now, the 87 starting five, you had Keith Smart went in the second round the next year. Steve Alford obviously was a second rounder to Dallas. Dean Garrett at starting center was a second rounder, went to Europe, came back, and then had a nice NBA career. Ricky Callaway transferred, ended up going, I think, undrafted, maybe was a late round pick, and Daryl Thomas was a sixth round pick. So no first rounder on Indiana's 87 roster.
Would Villanova have a first rounder this year?
Well, that's what he was saying.
The Gillespie kid, I think, is a great college basketball player, Jermaine Samuels as well, but I don't know if, obviously, Duke. You would think Carolina with Armando Bacot, not to mention, you know, maybe some of those guards grow into it, and Kansas has potentially several. So if you missed that, we'll probably double back on that late in the 9 o'clock hour. Joel Erickson is going to join us at 9 o'clock. He's been down to the NFL League meetings talking with Jim Irsay, Chris Ballard, and Frank Reich. So anxious to get his thoughts on things, because we'll hit that a whole lot on this Wednesday morning. Sounds like the temp's supposed to be great today. Kind of the one outlier of the week up into the 70s. Hopefully you can get outside today and enjoy that. Kevin and Query on a Wednesday, 93.5, 107.5, The Fan.
The biggest piece to the puzzle is in place.
Matt Ryan and the Colts. How good is Matt Ryan?
What pieces fall next?
Irsay says all in. This team couldn't do all in.
I don't think they have the weapons enough to be really good.
So what are you going after?
When the puzzle's completed.
The Colts have
wide receivers.
A definitive need right there.
At a very high level.
You'll hear about it here on your home for Colts football.
You can sit here, bitch, whine, and moan every day, and you know I will.
93.5 and 107.5, The Fan.
No one should read your personal messages. That's why WhatsApp uses end-to-end encryption. It protects whatever you send before, during, and after you send it. Always message privately. WhatsApp.
The Mower Shop in Fishers has all your residential and commercial mowers, outdoor power equipment, parts, products, and service also at themowershop.com and 317-849-9500.
Join us live Friday at Ale Emporium in Castleton from 3 to 6 p.m. Join JMV for the Bud Light Mini Hoops Challenge. See you at Ale Emporium in Castleton starting at 3.
With FanDuel Sportsbook, NBA Same Game Parlays give you the chance to turn a little bet into a big-time payday. Hey, it's Mark from Kevin and Query. Choose any NBA game and combine multiple bets like the amount of three-pointers made, the leading score of the game, and more all into one wager for bigger wins. I've used Same Game Parlay on NBA games a lot this season. I really like rolling with player point totals, assists, and made threes, but you can build your same game parlay any way you want. Make the midseason feel like the playoffs when you bet on FanDuel Sportsbook. It's the top-rated sportsbook app because it's safe, secure, and easy to use. When you win, you get paid quickly. Plus, if you're a new customer, you can bet $5 and get $150 in site credit instantly guaranteed. So download the FanDuel Sportsbook app and sign up using promo code MARK to bet the NBA today. That's promo code MARK, M-A-R-C. 21 and over and present in Indiana. First online real money wager only. $10 first deposit required. Bonus issued is now withdrawable site credit that expires 14 days after receipt. Restrictions apply. See full terms at sportsbook.fanduel.com. Gambling problem? Call 1-800-9-WITH-IT.
You know you worked hard to build your wealth. You also know one must plan for the twists and turns ahead. The children growing up, empty nest realities, and the joys of retirement. There's something else you need to know. You're not alone in this. You have a wealth management partner in Edelman Financial Engines to work with you every step of the way. Whether it's personalized advice or our modeling of over 38,000 investments monthly to keep you current and focused. It also helps to know that we use a cost-effective, integrated approach to wealth planning. From tax-optimized portfolios to life-focused advice for retirement and the possibilities ahead. If you're asking, what more can I do to take my wealth potential to the next level? Call to schedule a free, no-obligation meeting with an Edelman Financial Engines advisor who knows what that takes. Call 833-PLAN-EFE or visit planefe.com today.
Hi, I'm a jewelry consultant at Shane Company. Visit us and you'll be dazzled by our stylish selection of jewelry you'll enjoy wearing every day. We have lots of styles you can personalize. Just select your favorite gemstone to create a one-of-a-kind necklace or ring. You can choose a radiant ruby or a sapphire. We have over a dozen colors, or a purple amethyst, London blue topaz, or peach morganite. We're known for our vibrant, natural gemstones. Customers love our signature shade of rose gold. It has a soft blush tone. We have all the classics in rose gold, hoop earrings, studs, tennis bracelets, you name it. We also have gorgeous gold chains in a variety of styles, including herringbone chains, paperclip chains, and more. If you want something extraordinary, check out Tom's Finds, our limited edition collections featuring rare gemstones from around the world. Whether you're looking to build your jewelry wardrobe with a classic, or you just want to treat yourself, come in and have some fun.
Now you have a friend in the jewelry business, Shane Company and ShaneCo.com.
At Gainbridge Fieldhouse, we protect home court.
That's blocked again by Turner.
We battle.
Washington drives, scores, and a foul.
We dig deep.
Nice pass, Brissett finishes.
For tip-off through the final buzzer. It's game time at the Fieldhouse.
It's one of your last chances to cheer on the blue and gold when the Denver Nuggets come to town. Catch the Pacers and Nuggets Wednesday at 7. Get your tickets at Pacers.com. That's Pacers.com. Pacers Nuggets Wednesday at 7.
The madness of hoops is down to 4, and real sports bettors use the free PropSwap app to find the best deals on all of your favorite teams. PropSwappers make thousands of dollars simply buying and selling college basketball teams. And here's the best part. You can buy and sell on PropSwap without even leaving your couch. And right now is the time to check it out with the Final Four coming this weekend. Blue Bloods are everywhere with 4 teams left. That means plenty of action to buy or sell on PropSwap. You can jump on the PropSwap app, buy a couple tickets, and enjoy buckets of cash and the moments of madness. See a ticket you like, but think the price is a little bit too high? You can submit a bid for a price you think is fair and then buy it. You'll find exclusive fantastic features on PropSwap, like filtering listed bets based on the best value, a free activity fee to stay in the know with red-hot tickets for sale, and a loyalty rewards program that turns your ticket sales into extra bonus cash. PropSwap is America's number one app to buy and sell sports bets. Download the free app today.
Finding the right person for the job isn't easy. Just ask someone who hired a lounge singer to be their office receptionist.
Hello, this is Mickey Marquis, and you've reached the office of Duggan Associates. Thank you very much. Catch me Tuesday nights at the Hotel Johnson. Hello?
But if you've got an insurance question, you can always count on your local GEICO agent. They can bundle your policies, which could save you hundreds.
Duggan Associates, this is Mickey Marquis. Hello?
For expert help with all your insurance needs, visit geico.com/local today.
And now it's GEICO's Motorcycle Rules of the Road. Avoid biking in the rain and never touch another person's bike.
Hey guys, look at these bikes. So shiny. Whoops.
I'm gonna leave a note. Oh, gosh, there's more.
And the rule to saving on motorcycle insurance is, in 15 minutes, GEICO could save you 15% or more.
This SportsCenter update on 93.5 and 107.5 The Fan is presented by Big O Tires, the team you trust.
All right, tonight the Pacers are back in action. They've got the Nuggets. That is 7 o'clock tip there. I guess we're on Cleveland Cavaliers watch for the next week as well. They remain in that 7th spot. Again, that is a lottery-protected pick that the Cavs would send to Indiana if they make the playoffs. Right now they're in the play-in game. That would be lottery-protected again next year as well. So kind of a two-year watch on that. Jake, I don't want to overreact too much to that, but I think the Pacers will be well served to get that pick this year. I think you need to get all the rebuild done kind of this offseason. Sure. Let those guys grow together and just have multiple ways to maneuver.
And if you can get Mark Williams with the 19th pick, I'm telling you. Cleveland tonight taking on Dallas, 7 o'clock. Last night, the Cavs were idle. The big story last night in the NBA, how about Utah with a 25-point lead, surrendering it? Donovan Mitchell pulling a Chris Webber, calling a timeout when they had none left. Paul George had 34 clips over the Jazz, 121-115, overcoming a 25-point deficit.
George's first game in quite a while. Correct. There. The Lakers right now outside of the Western Conference playoff picture as they deal with injuries to LeBron James and Anthony Davis. So the final 2 weeks of the season, I know not a lot of playoff race watch here necessarily, but a whole lot to watch in both the East and the West. Looking ahead to this weekend, again, we've mentioned the Final Four down in New Orleans for the men's, the women's Final Four in Minneapolis, South Carolina, Louisville, Stanford, and UConn. Tonight, we forgot to ask Mike DeCourcy about this, Jake, but tonight is the night on the pitch for the United States men's national team. A win, a draw, or lose by 5-0 or less? Did I say that correct?
Yeah, that's okay. Right. They can't go level.
5-0 or less, and they will qualify for the 2022 World Cup at Costa Rica. 9 o'clock on the pitch. Will you stay up for that?
Oh, absolutely. I'll be up anyway. Costa Rica, by the way. My Vuvuzela?
Yeah, Vuvuzela. Yep.
That's right. Costa Rica, the rich coast. I know that much. Aren't you impressed? No. San Juan, I believe, the capital of Costa Rica. Is that right?
I thought it was San Jose.
San Jose, maybe? San Juan's definitely Puerto Rico, but I thought it was... Can you look that up, Mark? I think you're right. I think it is San Jose. I just remember it's always a city name that there's another one that you think of more than that city.
Do you know the region that the United States tries to qualify in the World Cup for? Like, what's it called? The Canada, Mexico, United States, Caribbean country?
The Americas.
CONCACAF.
I did know that because don't they have like a tournament that's something along that line?
Yeah, and I'm sure there's separate tournaments outside of the World Cup cycle, but the United States trying for that tonight. Again, yesterday...
I had a CONCACAF in high school, and then ointments and things like that took care of it.
Yeah. Is that what your moles called?
That's right. They called yesterday to say my CONCACAF is normal.
We're going to get a whole lot into the NFL owners' meetings here over the next hour. Some interesting comments, Jim Irsay related, per usual. Down there. Here was Irsay yesterday speaking to Colts.com about Matt Ryan and that trade.
It just wasn't even clear. You couldn't, you know, go into this offseason and say, well, Matt Ryan's available, you know. You certainly couldn't predict, you know, if you decided to trade Carson, if you could get anything at all, you know. And so it was a real blessing, a real positive thing for Colts fans. I don't think I can emphasize, you know, the positive, because we could, you know, be sitting here with a much different scenario right now. So we couldn't be more excited.
Does
he have a sinus infection?
I feel like allergy season's starting up. I got kind of one nostril. It's not really fully there.
Granted, sounds like he's got a conca cave.
Granted, the Palm Beach allergies are probably a little different than the Indianapolis allergies. If you're a Commanders fan, you won't want to hear Jim Irsay's comments yesterday. But we'll get a lot into that. An interesting defensive free agent signing that Irsay hinted at as well. What does all chips in mean? We'll break all that down for you coming up here. Kevin and Query on a Wednesday. 93.5, 107.5, The Fan.
Loud and proud. join me today. Seth Greenberg is going to join. We're going to talk Final Four as we move towards New Orleans. Also, Ryan Burr, he'll talk Final Four. He'll give you some golfers and just basically talk. Join me noon to 3 today.
We buy any car. We buy any car. We buy any car. Any.
Trading in or selling your car, truck, or SUV, WeBuyAnyCar.com takes the hassle out of selling in just 3 easy steps. 1. Get your free online valuation. 2. Drive to your local car buying center. And 3. Walk out with your check in as little as 30 minutes. So don't wait. Get your free online valuation now at WeBuyAnyCar.com.
Find out how much your car's worth at WeBuyAnyCar.com.
Enjoy all your favorite sports like never before at BetMGM. Sign up using the code The Fan, capital T, capital F, all one word, and your first wager is risk-free up to $1,000. When you register with BetMGM, you'll get instant access to a variety of parlay selection features, live betting options, player props, and daily boosted odds specials. With BetMGM at your fingertips, every game and every play matter more than ever. Sign up today and find out why nothing beats a win at the King of Sportsbooks. Download the BetMGM app today or go to BetMGM.com and again, enter that code THEFAN, all one word, and place your first wager risk-free. Visit BetMGM.com for terms and conditions. 21 years of age or older to wager. Indiana only. New customer offer. All promotions are subject to qualification and eligibility requirements. Rewards issued as non-withdrawable free bets or site credit. Free bets expire 7 days from issuance. If you or someone you know has a gambling problem and wants help, call 1-800-9-WITH-IT.
The Fed has raised rates, but it's not too late for you.
There's still time to lock in Golden Oak Lending's low 3.25% rate.
I'm James Hawkins, president of Golden Oak, and I urge you to call now. With home values at all-time highs and Golden Oak Lending's low rates, you can pull more cash out of your home.
Call 317-706-GOLD today to get a free mortgage checkup and find out how much cash you can get. It's more than you think.
That's right. Plus, Golden Oak still has millions of dollars available at near record low rates, and you can skip 2 mortgage payments.
Lock in this low 3.25% rate. And if we can't close your loan, the appraisal is no charge. Call 317-706-GOLD.
Golden Oak Lending cured my blues.
NMLS 114937, 3.25% fixed, 4.361% APR. FHA 15-year mortgage with 20% equity and approved credit.
Hi, this is Ted Bishop, PGA General Manager at the Legends Golf Club in Franklin. This year, we are celebrating our 30th anniversary of being in business, and I want to personally invite you to become a member at our course, which was selected as the 2021 Indiana Golf Course of the Year. We are offering a limited number of 2-year Monday through Friday memberships starting at $199 a year. Yep, you heard it right, only $199 a year, and you can upgrade to a 7-day membership for only $50 per year more. If you ride, you just pay for the golf cart, and if you walk, there's no additional charge. These memberships will expire on December 31 of 2023. Legends has 27 Fazio Design Championship holes. Our regular players will tell you that we are known for great playing conditions and a friendly staff. Join the Legends Golf Club today. Don't delay, because limited spots are available. Call 317-736-8186 or buy online at thelegendsgolfclub.com. And I'll see you on the first tee.
Finding great candidates to hire can be like, well, trying to find a needle in a haystack. Sure, you can post your job to some job board, but then all you can do is hope the right person comes along, which is why you should try ZipRecruiter for free at ziprecruiter.com/hire. ZipRecruiter doesn't depend on candidates finding you. It finds them for you. Its powerful technology identifies people with the right experience and actively invites them to apply to your job. You get qualified candidates fast. So while other companies might deliver a lot of hay, ZipRecruiter finds you what you're looking for. The needle in the haystack.
See why 4 out of 5 employers who post a job in ZipRecruiter get a quality candidate within the first day. ZipRecruiter, the smartest way to hire. And now you can try ZipRecruiter for free. That's right, free. At ZipRecruiter.com/hire. That's ZipRecruiter.com/hire. ZipRecruiter.com/hire.
With PatriotSoftware.com, accounting and payroll, keep your time and money.
Mike Campbell here, serial entrepreneur.
I started my first business in the basement of a factory over 30 years ago. We had no heat and no air conditioning. Instead of customers, our office visitors were rats, birds, flies, and snakes. Our office flooded often, and we used blankets as our office walls. We were broke and needed help. That's why I created Patriot Software, to help small business owners with simple payroll for 1 to 100 employees. And if you need help, we will help you for free. Go to PatriotSoftware.com. Use promo code RADIO and get 2 months of payroll processing free. That's PatriotSoftware.com.
With PatriotSoftware.com, accounting and payroll, keep your time and money.
And I came together. Might as well do your worst to me.
You're listening to Kevin and Querry on 93.5 and 107.5, The Fan.
Thanks again to Mike DeCourcy who joined us. That'll be up on the podcast soon. Talking college basketball on the cusp here, the Final Four on a Wednesday. Kevin and Querry, Jake Querry along with Kevin Bowen, Mark Dykton here as well. Kevin, big storyline yesterday in the late afternoon that we will now kind of break down a little bit is Jim Irsay, and this happens every year, of course, meeting with the media that down at the owners' meetings, and just kind of a state of the franchise type address, if you will.
Yeah, I think that's a good way to put it. And I do want to mention, forgot to mention it yesterday, thanks to Mike Chappell for helping us out with Jacob Tammy, getting him on air yesterday. I thought Tammy was terrific, and if you missed that interview, that is up on the podcast as well. So yeah, Jim Irsay yesterday, and you know these comments come courtesy. We'll have Joel Erickson on around 9 o'clock. He's going to join us from the Indy Star. Sat in on the Irsay, Ballard, Frank Reich, various pressers over the past few days. But Zach Kiefer and Stephen Holder were down there as well. And I guess I'll read a couple of these quotes to you, Jake. And this is Irsay talking about the Wentz decision. He goes, it was just something that we had to move away from as a franchise. It was very obvious. Another quote. Oh my God, there's something wrong here and it needs to be corrected. End quote. And the third one that really stood out to me. Sometimes you feel like you have to move on because you can't persuade people to do things different if they don't want to do them differently.
Okay. That last one, and listen.
You ever seen an owner go there?
It bothers me that I have to make this disclaimer every time, but I understand it, right? This is not me speaking. For some reason, people, when I decipher what the owner is saying, people think that it's me saying this about Carson Wentz. This isn't me speaking. I personally think when it comes to the vaccine, Carson Wentz is a free man that is an adult and can make his own decisions. That's why we live in this country. Having said that, I'm vaccinated, by the way. Having said that, Jim Irsay has been very open about the fact that he was disappointed in Carson Wentz's decision to not get vaccinated. And people thought that we were making this up or that we were planting our own political agenda in some sort of a weird hope. No.
You think that last quote is strictly vaccine, though?
I think it's... read it again.
Sometimes you feel like you have to move on because you can't persuade people to do things different if they don't want to do them differently. I think a majority of it is, Jake, but I don't think it's the
I'm not saying
quote.
It's entirely, but there's no doubt that it's rooted in that, right?
Rooted, yes, but I also, again, feel like we've gotten to this point where was Carson Wentz really bad in the Jacksonville game? Yes. Did Trevor Lawrence have the easiest opening drive of his life to start that game?
Correct. I get it.
And Darius Leonard, unvaccinated, missed precious time late in the season. Did your offensive line play one of the worst games I've seen them play in quite some time? Jonathan Taylor had 18 rushing yards on 8 carries.
Look, I mean, points,
in the first half
points
of that
well
game.
Taken. I'm telling you. Okay.
It just seems a little over the top from Irsay right now. I appreciate his honesty.
Kevin, it comes down to this. I get what you're saying, okay? But sometimes, you ever work with people that within your own company, when you worked for the Colts or other jobs, that you look at it and you're like, how did this guy seems to get away with stuff that other people don't? Like, well, that's just how he is. Oh, so like when he started the job, he set a precedent that like that's how he was, and so therefore that was just the tone, and therefore like different rules apply to that person. The way that you start out a job sets the tone oftentimes for how your job is going to go, good or bad, either way. I think what we're seeing there, Kevin, this is what I've said from day one, and I'm going to stand right here on Monument Circle and basically say, I don't want to be that guy, but I'm going to be that guy by saying, how you like me now, not to you. How do you like us now? We were right. And that is this. When Jim Irsay, at the beginning of the football season, was the most vociferous owner in the National Football League about his desire to see players get vaccinated. Whether or not you agree with that, disagree with that, whether you're tired of hearing the word vaccine, and I get all of that. I trust me, nobody is more tired of hearing it than I am about saying it. But the reality is it is still a topic because it set a tone that rubbed him the wrong way. And from the beginning, I truly believe that he said to Carson Wentz, if you want to go this route and not do what I am strongly advising that I can't make you do, but I'm hoping very strongly you do, and yes, Darius Leonard took the same path. Yes, Quentin Nelson took the same path. They don't touch the football every single play. There is no more important position in professional sports than the quarterback of a National Football League team. And I believe that Jim Irsay made that request to Carson Wentz. Carson Wentz said, I'm not going to do that. That is his free will, and that is his choice as an adult to do so. And I think that Jim Irsay said, that is your free will and choice, but you are greatly, greatly shrinking your margin for error if you don't play well. And at the end of the year, when they needed it most, he sat in a corner and puked on his jersey. The rest of the team did not play well. You are correct. But Carson Wentz fell victim to the precedent he set when he first walked in the door and the tone of the relationship that was set between he and the owner.
Yeah, I feel like Irsay just let that. Again, I don't think Wentz was the right answer, but I think this is a pretty emotional move by Irsay, because I stand by it.
No disagreement.
Him and Frank Reich couldn't differ more on this. And it's interesting to me, Jim brings up a good point. Jim goes, so Jim Irsay had to be talked into signing off on Wentz by Reich. Yesterday's comments reflected unhappiness and frustration, which were only directed at Carson, yet he speaks glowingly of Frank. Isn't Reich equally responsible for this debacle? Is it kind of a double standard in how he talks about Frank Reich when he's so vehemently upset about Carson Wentz, yet he doesn't seem to lay any of that blame at the feet of Frank Reich when Reich was the one that ultimately did the full sell? And yes, Chris Ballard signed off on it, but aren't your GM and head coach responsible for having him here?
I don't disagree with that.
It just seems like he is not acknowledging the mistake that those two made.
Correct. I would agree with that.
Like, are they on any sort of a hot seat? Should they be? I mean, if you're this mad, if it set your franchise back in some manner, then where's the accountability for the GM, Kevin, and the head coach?
Okay. Excellent question. And let me, again, preface, and I only do it because I think sometimes some things do need disclaimers of clarity. You ever dated somebody? I'm not saying you personally, you're a married guy, but you ever known somebody that dated a girl that, like, you're like, what is he doing with that girl? Like, she's kind of lame. And people are like, yeah, but if you could see her last girlfriend was crazy. His last girlfriend was crazy.
Sure.
So, like, she trust me, like, he seems happy with her because it's a lot less hassle than the previous. Chuck Pagano's a good man. I personally like Ryan Grigson. I've gotten to know him a little bit personally. I think there are some insecurities there, but I like him as a guy. Okay? But there was so much dysfunction with Ryan Grigson and Chuck Pagano and them not getting along and then attached at the hip and the 11th hour press conference and yada, yada, yada. There was so much of that I think Jim Irsay looks at Chris Ballard and Frank Reich. And let me tell you something, Kevin. They got the biggest pass of all, right? Because they're following up the previous administration. Irsay's like, I don't want to go back to that. So they get a lot more. The tightened leash that Carson Wentz had is the same level of tightness as the flexibility that Frank Reich and Chris Ballard have because of tone set when they walked in the door. And those two walked in, Frank Reich and Chris Ballard, and walked in as the perception immediately of, well, this is a lot more adult and normal than what I was used to before. And so, therefore, they get a longer pass. I really believe that.
I do think, going back to that quote, Adam mentions here, I think his quote is more about Wentz's refusal to take the layup versus trying for that big play. I do think there's more. Yes, is the root of it at the vaccine, Jake? Sure. But is there a stubbornness? Was there a stubbornness from Carson with coaching and adjusting the style of play? I do think there is some of that in that quote as well. It just seems like it's gotten to the point now where the sole blame and the demanding of change from Jim Irsay is only at the feet of the quarterback, and there's not a refusal to acknowledge other failures within your organization that has gotten to the this franchise to the point
but
where
here's the thing.
We're discussing another season of missing the playoffs and not winning a playoff game.
Kevin, there's a theme here with me, and that theme is that we as humans assess things based on the precedent of how they based on two things: how they began and the precedent of comparison. For Jim Irsay, how did things begin with Carson Wentz? They began with Carson Wentz and Jim Irsay having a philosophical difference on approach of something, and Carson Wentz going and standing by his belief. That's fine. But then when it comes down to it, they go hand in hand, pardon the pun. When you're talking about throwing with the left hand, holding onto the ball too long, Jim Irsay, instead of saying, look, he can work through this, Jim Irsay has it in his mind, what's the precedent? What's the very first impression? Gee, the first thing that I told this guy I wanted him to change, he didn't change. He went his own way. So why in the world do I think he's going to now? We got to get rid of him. Secondly, when it comes to Jim Irsay being hung up on the quarterback and overlooking the inefficiency to block, the inefficiency to stop Trevor Lawrence on the first drive, the inefficiency of wide receiver play, he is coming off of not one but two previous quarterback administrations where he had quarterbacks that masked everything. And so in his mind, that is the position that you can overlook other areas, because so long as you get that one right, it's easier to get that one right than to go five different areas. Because what did we find out when Peyton Manning got hurt? Oh, gosh. Some of these brilliant moves that the Colts had made weren't so brilliant after all, because it was a house of cards, and they pulled out the ace of spades and everything crumbled. And so I think he looks at it now and goes, as long as I got the ace of spades, the rest of the house of cards sits intact.
317-239-TED70 if you want to join the conversation. Irsay had an interesting comment about a defensive free agent signing. We'll play that audio here coming up in just a second. That could be a big name that I want to react to as well. He mentioned that they were potentially involved with a young quarterback and were willing to give up a couple of first-round picks for said quarterback. Any names you believe fall into that category?
You know, Deshaun Watson was the first name that came to mind, but then I saw the deposition video of Deshaun Watson and thought, probably be a good thing that they avoided that.
First name is Kyler Murray for me.
I could see that. That would be, that would make sense.
He said something to the effect of, like, we needed one more other thing to fall. We needed something else to happen for that.
Well, there's only, I mean, if you were to make a list of young quarterbacks that even would have been attainable, that's the only reason I said Watson.
I mean, does Derek Carr qualify as young? I don't think so. Yeah.
Kyler Murray was the guy I immediately thought of when he said that.
Yeah, because obviously we heard in February.
He scrubbed his Cardinals, everything Cardinals on his social media.
And whatnot.
What a diva.
The whole
Hey, let's get football's Paul George in here. That's what this city needs.
Jake, welcome to 2022 athletes. I think, unfortunately, we're seeing that more and more. I saw someone mention to me, who was it? Was it Hines that scrubbed his social media? I don't know. Some Colt player scrubbed their social media and people were freaking out about that. The all chips in comment, some clarification there. Irsay mentioned this. For any of those that were kind of locked into, he says all chips in, that means spending. Irsay said emotional and mental commitment to excellence and greatness by anyone in the circle.
I thought that was obvious, to be honest with you. It's just a mindset, right? A guy that when he walks in the building, you know he is totally invested in winning.
Yeah, I get why some fans thought it could be a financial sense considering you have the most cap space in the NFL. Jake, that comment, though, is interesting. And I know you have laughed this off many times, but, like, isn't this supposed to be a football team of a bunch of high-character football players? And there's not an emotional and mental commitment to excellence and greatness by anyone in the circle? I've always said this.
Always surprised they can play on Sunday, considering they're all in the Mormon Tabernacle Choir, right?
I've always said this. I feel like you need a screw or two loose in that locker room to challenge some people, to hold people accountable. I thought DeNico Autry, in a way, brought a little bit of that. I think Yannick Ngakoue has a little bit of a track record of providing some of that, so I'm curious if that will change things. But last offseason, when the Colts in the spring chose not to take part in any sort of physical OTAs, I mean, it was, there's more intensity on Eastwood Middle School's recess than there is over at West 56th Street last spring. That was a red flag to me of like, whoa, is this team and this staff not all together on what has transpired in recent years? You've lost six straight season openers. You haven't won a division title in X amount of years. You've got one of the toughest opening stretches to a schedule that you'll see. And while there's many teams around the league that are doing some things more physically in the spring, the Colts chose to come here and, you know, scratch each other's back for 2 weeks on the football field. That was a big red flag of like, okay, I don't see the level of commitment that is necessary given how the starts of seasons have unfolded in recent years for this team.
Is the patience running thin for fans? And I'm not saying that it's time to send him out to pasture, don't get me wrong. But 2 years ago, all I heard was like Chris Ballard was this boy wonder and what a stroke of genius it was that he's running the franchise. Do fans, I don't know, I'm asking, no, do fans still feel that way?
No, I think fans are starting to get a little irritated about it, especially in the Ballard camp. But, Jake, I go back to what I said earlier. I don't think Jim Irsay feels any differently about this duo. All right. I think he feels as strongly about them as he did when he hired Frank Reich the year after hiring Chris Ballard. Which, again, to Jim's earlier point, is odd to me, considering the venom he has towards the Carson Wentz decision. It's very interesting. And I want to get Joel Erickson's thoughts on that when he joins us in the 9 o'clock hour. All right, we come back. We'll play that audio. Jim Irsay talking about a particular defensive free agent. What does he mean by that? Who does he mean by that? Play that audio. We come back. 8 o'clock hour on a warm but a breezy Wednesday morning here in the city of Indianapolis.
The Ride with JMV.
Honestly, I think we are all skeptical about how the Colts were going to get out of this quarterback situation. Also, Chris Ballard is just cleaning up a mess that the Colts made. This is what happened when the owner wants only 1 year from Carson Wentz. But I will say this, they made the best out of what was a messy situation. They think they can win the AFC South with Matt Ryan. We'll see.
The Ride with JMV.
Weekdays 3 to 6.
On 93.5 and 107.5. The Fan.
Do you feel boxed in by the pressures of running your business? With 30-plus years of HR experience, Insperity can help lighten your load. Expand your possibilities at Insperity.com.
Realtors don't just send their clients to us, they use us too. Get pre-approved today for your refinance or home purchase at thehomeloanexpert.com.
NMLS number 1326241.
You know, Carson Wentz reading those comments yesterday, boy, he might feel a little physical pain in some areas that he didn't think he had. But if you're suffering from joint pain every day, you can get help from QC Kinetics, the nation's leader in regenerative solutions that can restore and repair damaged tissue with no surgery and no drugs. This is the relief you've been hoping for your aching hips, knees, shoulder, and lower back. The unique protocols at QC Kinetics were created by a physician with years of study in regenerative medicine, and they're treating patients every day in hundreds of clinics nationwide with remarkable success, life-changing results, and no downtime. It's the new, better, smarter, non-surgical, non-invasive way to deal with joint pain. And they're right here ready to help all of us right now. So call for a free consultation and make this spring and summer your best ever with no joint pain holding you back. Call QC Kinetics now for your free consultation. 463-235-7160. 463-235-7160.
Diamonds are April's birthstone, but any time is a good time for diamonds. And when you give the gift of diamonds, it's truly a thrill. Visit Shane Company for stunning gifts, find jewelry that's so exquisite and beautiful, it'll take her breath away. We've designed gorgeous styles in every price range, including diamond earrings, necklaces, rings, and bracelets. Our diamonds are natural, and since no two are alike, your piece will be one of a kind, a symbol as unique as she is. Shane Company jewelry is crafted to the highest standards, set with diamonds we hand-select for beauty and hand-match for consistency. In fact, we make our jewelry with such care, we're able to offer a free lifetime warranty. Come in and chat with our friendly and knowledgeable team of non-commissioned jewelry consultants. We'll make it fun to find a diamond gift, something solely for her enjoyment that will last forever.
Now you have a friend in the jewelry business, Shane Company and ShaneCo.com.
Hey, it's Big Joe for Big O Tires, the place for the lowest price on every tire every day. And with each store being locally owned and operated, Big O knows that car expenses are typically unexpected, so they offer no credit needed financing. No matter what your budget, they take care of you at Big O. They'll also take care of your brakes, alignments, oil changes, fluids, batteries, and more. Make your appointment with Shane in Mooresville, Josh in Plainfield, Alan in Lebanon, Mike in Brownsburg, Steve and Victor in Whitestown, and Derek at the Indy location at 86 and Zionsville Road at BigOTires.com. Big O Tires, the team you trust.
Every dribble, every pass, and every bucket, all in the palm of your hand. Because now you can sign up and bet. No strings attached with Bet River Sportsbook app featuring award-winning customer service. Live in-game bets, player props, and instant betting bucket to bucket. Don't miss out on all the big games. Get in the action with Bet River Sportsbook app.
Must be 21. Must be located in Indiana. Gambling problem? Call 1-800-9-WITH-IT. 1-800-994-8448.
This is Sarah's O'Reilly Auto Parts story.
Driving cross-country with two young children is ambitious, to say the least. Then our check engine light came on. We pulled into O'Reilly Auto Parts and they tested it. Turned out it was a faulty sensor. They referred us to a great mechanic just down the street and we were back on the road in no time.
Oh, 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 O'Reilly Auto Parts.
Hey, it's Stan Dockage here for my friends at AAA. You and I both know it is pothole season, man. It is crazy out there. You hit a pothole, you get a flat tire. Some of you have got multiple flats. You got to keep your head on a swivel and you got to go slow. Do you really want to change a flat? Really? On the side of the road, cars and trucks zooming by 75 miles an hour. You got people not paying attention on phones. I do not. So get in the club. Do yourself a favor and join AAA today. At AAA, in the club, you get a flat tire fix, dead battery fix. You run out of gas, they come. Lock your keys in the car. AAA is there 24/7, 365. To get your AAA membership, visit AAA.com or call 844-GO-AAA-GO or stop by your local AAA office. And don't forget to ask about complimentary travel planning, great insurance rates, as well, home, auto, life, and more. Because you don't have to be stuck on the side of the road to get assistance from AAA.
93.5 and 107.5, The Fan.
WIBC HD2, W298BB, WIBC HD3, W228CX, Indianapolis.
The Pacers welcome the Denver Nuggets to the Fieldhouse this evening at 6:30 on 93.5 and 107.5, The Fan.
Listening to Kevin and Querry on 93.5 and 107.5, The Fan.
8 o'clock hour here on Kevin and Querry. 70 degrees today, but it sounds like some blustery winds later in the day.
It's what happens when the storm. When you go from cold to warm, it's got to blow in somehow, right?
This is kind of your meteorological. Logical hat, thank you. That you put on back in February about the no more freezing days.
Yeah, how about that, man? Could I have been more wrong?
I do feel like it should warm up a little bit more.
You were the one that took care of Milltown Mel. It was you. You gave us six more weeks of winter, my friend.
He's the one he was the poor groundhog. What state was that in?
New Jersey. Which is not surprising. Well,
he got whacked, right? He crossed somebody.
He had some gambling debts. Didn't pay off the right people. And
they went to go get him out on Groundhog Day, and unfortunately, he had shut it down.
Oh, sayonara. Your house collapsed on you. What a shame.
Sayonara there. Could the Colts be welcoming a new defensive free agent. Jim Irsay, we'll play this audio here. This was JJ Stankovic of Colts.com yesterday down at the owners' meetings in Palm Beach. A couple of interesting things, I think, in this clip here. So I'll have Mark play Irsay and react to him.
We could have, there could be, it would have to be at the right price because we don't have much cap room. In addition, you know, that excites some. But we'll see. You know, it's possible. I know Chris Ballard's looking hard at that, trying to find the right, individual, but it has to be the right guy at the right number, but one more veteran possibly to come in and make a big difference.
Now, what players are out there that they could be talking about this late in the game?
Well, if you don't mind, Jake, I do want to start with the we don't have much cap room comment.
That jumped out at me as well.
Is someone brainwashing Jim Irsay and not showing him the books?
Well, what do they have left? $16 million?
I'm seeing $22 million after the restructuring of Matt Ryan's contract.
Okay, that may be right.
That is currently the third most cap space in the NFL. So I don't know where that comes from, to be honest with you. And now to his other comment, who could that be? The first name that I thought of defensively, given what he said there, I thought Tyrann Mathieu, the Honey Badger. Safety, DB, turns 30, coming up here in May, just played in Kansas City, stopping Houston. That was the name that I thought of. Some other, I would say, bigger name defensive free agents that remain out there. You have Jadeveon Clowney. I mean, I don't know. Does he still qualify as like a...
Does Tyrann Mathieu still qualify?
I feel like Matthew's been a little bit more productive lately than him.
Stephon, he's a good player, but...
Stephon Gilmore would be the other one.
I don't want...
Cornerback.
Let me ask you a question. In referring to the Washington Commanders football team, if referencing something they did in 1987, are you not supposed to use the name?
You mean like don't say Redskins?
Right.
That's a good question. I don't know.
I mean, in 1993, if I'm referencing the franchise, it was the Washington Redskins, right?
Sure.
The 1993 Washington, I think it was 93 or one of those years. I remember when the Redskins went out in free agency and loaded up on players, and it was like, good Lord, they just stockpiled the NFC Pro Bowl team, but it was the 88 Pro Bowl team. I don't remember the exact years that I'm talking about, but I do recall a time when Washington loaded up on free agents that were huge names. The LA Lakers. When the Lakers, it was a slam dunk they were going to win the title because they had Gary Payton and Karl Malone. Okay, but it was late issue, Gary Payton, Karl Malone. Are we at the point now, Kevin, where the guys that you're talking about, the names that we're talking about, Honey Badger, Jadeveon Clowney, are you getting them the three-year past prime version of them?
I think Matthew still qualifies as a really impactful player. I mean, he was an all-pro in 2019, 2020. And that's not that long ago. He played, I think he only missed one game last season, so it's not like he had some major injury that rose up. He finds the ball, which I know is a really important trait for what the Colts look for in defensive backs, as a guy that, by all accounts, extremely intelligent player as well. I think that is key. And also, if you look at kind of where the Colts are defensive back-wise right now, I do think one more addition there makes a lot of sense. Your cornerback group has added a guy in Brandon Faison that right now he'd be a starter for you. They've lost Rock Ya-Sin and Xavier Rhodes, so you're kind of down two corners, added one. Certainly Isaiah Rogers would grow into more of a role. And then at safety, you've got Julian Blackman coming off that torn Achilles. And how do you look at that? Do you look at Julian Blackman as, hey, he can be Cam Akers of the Rams and come back from Achilles in 6 months? Or do you look at it and say, oh boy, this could be Marlon Mack.
Really good player when he's healthy,
Eric
right?
Fisher, tremendous player. Yeah. So that's, I think, the dilemma that you're at. Matthew has history of playing a little bit of corner, a little bit of safety as well. I think he'd add some versatility. This is a move that I would like to see get done.
I think you're not the only one. Let's go to the phone lines. Line one, Matthew's in Maine. Maine Matthew is actually going to be. That's your name on the show is Maine Matthew. Is that cool?
Yep, that's fine.
You want honey badger or you don't want honey badger?
No, I do.
Do you think, okay, so you tell me this. You want Tyrann Mathieu, why? Do you think there's still gas in the tank? And would you compromise like the salary cap or go up against, I don't know what he would cost, but are you worried about the tag at all, the price tag?
Yeah, I am. That's the primary reason I think maybe we won't get him. But yes, I think he still has gas in the tank. And I am slightly biased just because we do share a name, so he would be the only player I would break the I don't buy jerseys anymore for.
Oh, you wait a minute. You would buy a jersey.
I mean, you got to.
I guess you're right,
I have
yeah.
to, because I can have it for life.
That's a good point.
You could only play one game, and it wouldn't matter.
then it becomes just your jersey, right?
Matthew, thank you again for the care package a couple, I guess it was about just a week ago as well, from Maine. My wife is loving the Maine jam. Doesn't that sound? Yeah. That should be their new. I do like their G League team, the Red Claws, but I feel like the Maine jam would work
well. Matthew, have you ever gone to see the Red Claws play?
No, I haven't. They changed their name last year for some ridiculous reason. But
is it not the Red Claws anymore?
No, they're the Celtics now.
Oh, see, that's the problem.
It's a cop-out right there.
Yeah, the G League does this with every team now, right?
The minor league teams need to be independent with their nicknames.
Would you buy a Maine Red Claws jersey, Kevin?
I feel like you're one day away from a Maine Red Claw hat. I feel like that could be next on the Jake Query.
That's right.
Apparel edition. I'm curious if Matthew, looks at the situation, though, in Indy. He's like, okay, where exactly do I see, every down playing time? Do you bring him here? Does that mean Kari Willis and a healthy Julian Blackman, one of those, would go to the bench?
Well, how many others are looking at Tyrann Mathieu is the other question.
Yeah, I mean, that's fair, too. And, I mean, Irsay, for what it's worth, was very stringent there in that clip about value, value, value. Is Tyrann Mathieu pretty stringent on what he views his value? And he's not going to go anywhere until he kind of gets that. When you get into late March and early April, I think that's something to keep an eye on as well.
By the way, speaking of late March, early, when is Capital open back up? Do we know?
2026.
I'm just kind of waiting for you to tell me that. Because you test the waters over there every day.
Yeah, okay. So if you drive down Capital, and this is easy to do. Now, here's the thing this morning where I got hung up a little bit. So I drive down Capital, and then just south of, at 16th Street, it ends. It's closed. And for a while there, like when you got the Methodist, I mean, it was like, don't even think about it. And everyone's hooking a left. Like the very first day it happened, it was like, what is going on? And everyone's hooking a left at like 20th, and it's a disaster. So then I figured out if you go down to 16th Street, there is a lane open in between Barrels where you can go west for one block. I think it's Senate, and then south. And then you hook back left again. Capitol's only closed for like one block.
See, when I did it, I was going all the way over to 65. And then getting off on Martin Luther King.
Yeah, but then you got to come in.
But that it's got the nice diagonal feed right back into Capitol at like New York.
Yeah, by the AUL building, right? Yeah. Or the whatever it's called now.
God, they had a great joke the other day out there. I'm trying to think of what it was.
The New Jersey one?
Yes, that was it.
You know that I had.
Did you laugh at that?
Well, I thought it was a little bit unoriginal. It just said, where do basketball players get their uniforms from New Jersey? I actually had
one
time.
I think you would appreciate that.
I came up with a slogan one time for that. And they gave me like a little mock, you get like a little plastic billboard because I came up with the slogan.
Oh, so they take ideas?
They called me because it was the month of May and they're like, can you give us a couple of examples or a couple of ideas for May? And I gave them like three, and they picked one of them, which was...
That had to be one of the happiest calls of your life.
Well, do you want to know what the slogan was that I came up with? It's not necessarily funny. I just... it said, May has arrived, milk it for all it's worth. And they used that. I was let me tell you something. The American Dairy Association people of Indiana were thrilled.
Give you honor roll student... stickers that you put that on like the back.
Yeah,
of your
mom's,
car.
My mom's.
I was
got
featured
a bumper
on the
sticker.
Billboard.
My mom's got a bumper sticker. My kid came up with the billboard.
Yeah, exactly. Jeremy makes a good point. Tyrann Mathieu brings that locker room edge that Kevin has talked about. I would agree.
That's true.
I think he brings some of that, which I believe is much needed. Darnell, you want to talk about Carson Wentz and Frank Reich? Hello. Darnell gone.
Darnell.
Trenton brought up to me the other day, Jake, this is kind of going back to our wide receiver conversation. He goes, hey, KB, is it possible that Frank Reich is the root of the wide receiver problem? I can see how Frank would go to bat for anyone and would be telling Ballard, oh, no, these guys are enough. Trust me. I'll make it work. Ultimately, though, it does fall into Ballard's hands to go out there and get those guys. Jake, I think Frank Reich would have public belief in you or I if we were on the depth chart.
That's fair. I mean, that's part of his job, is it not?
Sure, it's good to have belief, but when you're having closed-door conversations with your GM, you need to be brutally honest as well. You need to offer your opinion that is not, hey, all right, here we are, week six. We've got five guys that are hurt, and we got to go out there, and we got to believe in these guys, and we got to win. I think the evaluation is time for screw the internal belief, and, you know, here we are. It's going to be us 48 that are going into battle and all that. The offseason is when you've got to be honest. You've got to strip it down. You've got to really, I think, evaluate with an extremely critical eye. So to your point, Trent, I think more of it, and this gets back to what I was saying yesterday, more of it is on Ballard. It'd be one thing if the wide receivers you have in that room were former first, second-round picks or guys that had five-catch, 70-yard, two-touchdown games, you know, twice in their career when others were hurt and you feel like given more of an opportunity, they would ascend. We're talking about undrafted free agents, sixth-round picks, seventh-round picks. We're not talking about guys that are, like, knocking on the door. And they just need an opportunity to all of a sudden be a number two wideout behind Michael Pittman.
Hey, Jake, from day one, you actually called this about Carson Wentz. Maybe he's just not a good leader, but the reason that Irsay does not call out Ballard and Reich is because they are still involved in the relationship. That may be.
Still involved in what relationship?
Well, they still work for him. So, in other words, he's not going to call him out and throw him under the bus at the time because they're still there.
Yeah, I guess I'm not saying call him out, throw him under the bus, but I think just an acknowledgement of not using the word excellent to describe how their tenure has gone.
Hard to argue that.
That is not the word that I'd be using for a middle-of-the-pack AFC team. I think Irsay also believes, and Jake, I know you would probably disagree with this, Irsay believes that the Luck retirement has hamstringed this organization for... I would argue in Irsay's eyes, he thinks it's done it all the way up into 2022.
I mean, is it going to be the year 2045? And, I mean, obviously I'm not going to be here, but somebody's going to be doing this show and they're going to be like, you know, the Colts.
The show or Earth?
Either. Well, let's see.
Capital will be almost done by the time 2025.
In 2045, are people going to be like, well, you know, the Colts, it's a struggle, but, you know, Andrew Luck did retire in 2018 without anybody knowing it was coming or whatever year that was. I don't even remember at this point. What year was that?
Right before the 2019 season.
Yeah, I mean, yeah. It's the NFL, man. I mean, not for long. Isn't that what it stands for? I go back to that. I'm so sick and tired of the Andrew Luck excuse. I'm so sick and tired of it. We just saw a Super Bowl champion with a quarterback that was playing, that was going to the Henry Ford Museum in his off days in 2019, right? They needed a quarterback. They went out and got it.
Yeah, that would be my argument is, did Luck put the organization in an awful position doing
sure,
it 2 weeks before
of course.
The start of the season? Without a doubt. Have the Colts decided to go Band-Aid, Band-Aid, Band-Aid? Yes. They didn't have to go Band-Aid, Band-Aid, Band-Aid. They chose
right.
to go that route. Joe, you want the honey badger?
Yes, sir. I like the honey badger. I think he's got plenty left in his tank yet. And besides, I don't think we have anybody really as good as him right now. I mean, I think he'll be a good addition to the team. And I was also looking at the draft yesterday. There's 13 wide receivers in the draft. And according to some of the mock drafts, seven of them will be taken before our first pick. So I think we can get a good wide receiver, a fast one too, because there's plenty of fast ones out there from the draft to add and probably get two of them if they're smart.
Appreciate it, Joe. Thank you. Couple thoughts there, Jake. One, definitely the wide receiver draft, and I think this could be said for the next decade. Wide receiver's going to have depth in every draft. That's just how college football is
evolved. Yeah, you're right.
It's 7-on-7. You're going to have plenty of wideouts to be taken. I think that's part of the reason why you saw Kansas City look at Tyreek Hill and say, all right, unbelievable talent, but let's go find someone else in the draft.
Are the Colts prepared to make Nyheim Hines Tyreek Hill?
Well, gosh, wouldn't that be a dream?
You know what I mean, though. Yeah, Use him in that capacity.
I think Hines is going to be in the slot a whole lot more, which is huge, and I think it's necessary to get him more touches. The Colts have mentioned that as well. To Joe's point about drafting a wideout, though, Jake, what is interesting to me is Chris Ballard himself has said you cannot rely on wide receiver to come in and give you day one impact. So I hear you out, Joe. But again, Ballard, the main decision maker,
but that there's probably some truth to
said,
that. I agree with him on that.
Agreed. I'm not disagreeing with him on that. But it's like to be banking on wideout to help out Matt Ryan from day one, that's premature. That's a bit unrealistic to expect that. The other thing to your point there is without a first-round pick, Jake, I don't want to see the Colts entering the draft and pigeonholing themselves with that first selection. What if some whatever, cornerback, safety, quarterback, tight end, insert position here, starts falling and you had them 18 on your draft board and they're sitting there at 42,
right,
but yet you've painted yourself in this corner of like, oh, God, we got to take a wideout.
Best player available, Kevin.
You know, they always say best player available, but like.
And then they lie because I'll never forget, as I mentioned, the year that they took Bob, I think it was Bob Sanders, and Bill Polian came out. This is the guy we wanted from the get-go. We had him on the board. If we'd had the fifth pick overall, this is who we were going to take. I mean, this was the guy we wanted. We narrowed him in. This was the guy. He was, and the board went exactly as we expected. Later in the press conference, did you think about trading up at all? Well, we did actually have discussion, but the guy we were going to trade up for was off the board. Wait, what? Okay.
I always find it funny. Like, how many years did the Colts take a quarterback after drafting Peyton Manning 1 overall?
Right.
It's best player available at the position that is really needed on your roster. Let's get to one more call here. Again, Joel Erickson is going to join us at 9 o'clock. He was at the owners' meetings in Palm Beach and was with Jim Irsay, Chris Ballard, Frank Reich. So we'll get Joel's thoughts on that. But let's get to Paul. I think Paul wanted to talk not only Tyrann Mathieu, but Stephon Gilmore as well. What's up, Paul?
Yeah, what's up, fellas? How you guys doing?
Paul, how's the mail route?
It's always good.
All right.
Paul, I'm going to go out on a limb and say you were pretty happy with the Peacocks last Friday.
Yes, I was. But also, North Carolina is still available for me. So
there you go. Oh,
that's,
yeah.
That's good also.
I forgot you had them.
Yes. Also, yes, Stephon Gilmore, because of the defense that Gus Bradley wants to run, just runs rush force. We need another press corner who can play man-to-man like Isaiah Rodgers and the face-on that they just brought in because that's the defense that he played in Las Vegas last year. Also, Tyrann Mathieu, because he's a better safety than Willis. If you look last year, Willis always got burned in the pass. He was good in run coverage, but when it came to pass coverage, he was horrible. And with that, I have to disagree with you with one thing, Jake. Rookie wide receiver can make a difference. Look at what Chase Edmonds.
No, that's good.
Not Edmonds. Jamar Chase. For the Bengals.
Good
and
point.
Also, what the Dolphins rookie receiver did. So a rookie wide receiver can make a difference if
it
he
can.
Has the right one.
I will say, Paul, no doubt about it. And
thank you, Paul.
But at the same time, those are, for the most part,
top
exceptions to the rule, and you got to live with the rule, not the exception.
Jamar Chase, 5th overall. Jalen Waddle, I believe, was top 10 as well. So drafting 42 is just a little bit.
I mean, Reggie Wayne took a year to get going. You know,
I'm not saying this is shocking stuff. I'm not ripping rookie wideouts for sometimes not making an immediate impact. What I'm getting at is that should mean that more attention needs to be there at this time of year to get some proven wideouts in your room while still making sure that you look down the road at that position as well. All right, again, Joel Erickson going to join us at the top of the hour. The Colts overtime proposal also passed yesterday. We'll hit on that. Tarik Glenn going into the Ring of Honor. But let's get to a Big O Tire Sports Center update.
The SportsCenter update on 93.5 and 107.5 The Fan is presented by Big O Tires, the team you trust.
We'll start with the NBA. Pacers in action tonight, taking on the Nuggets at the Fieldhouse. Nugs coming in with a two-game win streak. Pacers with a four-game losing streak. Pacers are probably starting to scoreboard watch a little bit with Cleveland, as we've talked about, as the Cavs tonight host Dallas. Dallas comes in with a two-game win streak. That is critical because the Pacers want to make sure that Cleveland stays in the playoffs and that 19th or in that area pick is obtained for Indiana, because it is lottery protected, Kevin. So they want to make sure that that's where they would be able to have that pick. One note from the NBA last night, Dallas over the Lakers, 128-110. Lakers continue to slide. I lied. Two notes. The other one is the other team from L.A., the Clippers, down 25 in the third, come back to defeat the Utah Jazz, 121-115. Paul George had 34.
Six to go for the Pacers. The Nuggets tonight, it looks like they're going to be in that fifth spot if you do the reverse order heading into the lottery ping pong ball time. Again, six to go for them. It'll be Denver tonight. I know a lot of Pacers fans have probably missed out on seeing some visiting stars to Gainbridge Fieldhouse. It looks like Nikola Jokic is going to play tonight. He played the other night. The Nuggets are still very much competing for a playoff spot out west, so I would think you will get to see Mr. Jokic tonight.
By the way, the latest mock draft tankathon. Let me hit the simulator.
How late are we going?
Ooh, here we go. With the second pick in the 2022 NBA mock draft, the Indiana Pacers select Jabari Smith from Auburn University.
A lot of cheers there.
That's the guy that I would take number one if I had number one.
A lot of cheers there. A little bit of roster portal action. We saw Isaiah Thompson in the transfer portal for Purdue. Again, Indiana still has several guys there. I believe they are scholarship short. Jake, we still haven't gotten anything that Trace Jackson-Davis, Race Thompson.
Trace Jackson-Davis, I've now seen some discussion that maybe he's played his way into late first round. He's got to go if that's the case.
We had Mike DeCourcy on earlier. If you missed that, we'll re-rack it at 9:45. He did have an opinion on Trace Jackson-Davis and his status. You've got to feel like those dominoes need to fall for Indiana before they make some roster additions here in the offseason. Again, the Final Four coming up this Saturday, Villanova and Kansas. Kansas favored by just less than a handful of points. Duke favored in the second game by about the same margin. They've got North Carolina there. You want rich history, you want tradition, you certainly have it with this Final Four. Mike DeCourcy gave, what, Duke, Kansas? That's what he's expecting on Monday night?
That is what he said, yep.
He doesn't give Villanova much of a chance.
No, not at all. He was like, crazy?
A Justin Moore injury is significant. I think if there is a team, to your point, Jake, if there is a team and a coach to overcome that.
Love Jay Wright.
Jay Wright's resume, it just absolutely incredible there. So, again, New Orleans for the Final Four coming up this Saturday. We mentioned this yesterday. I don't know if you saw any of the pictures, Jake, but the U.S. swimming trials is going to be at Lucas Oil Stadium in 2024. Did you see any of the pictures of what it's going to look like?
No, but I'm kind of curious about it. I would assume kind of like what they did at Gainbridge, right?
So imagine like the Final Four setup from last year. Remember how they had two courts on the football field?
Yeah.
So you're going to have one pool with about 30,000 to 35,000 seats around said pool. And then there's going to be an additional, I think, two pools on the other side of the curtain. And that will be kind of for a warm-up area. Omaha was the last four U.S. Swim trial sites. And I didn't realize this. Indianapolis held the 1924 Olympic trials for swimming.
Remember I told you about this?
Did you tell me about this?
Well, there was a lifeguard.
Sorry for tuning you out.
There was a lifeguard at Broadpool Park.
Correct.
Who was a dynamic swimmer here in town. And
oh, you did tell
was
me about
part
this.
Of, yeah, it, or tragic. Was he was going towards being one of the Indianapolis representatives in that trial in 1924, but before it was just before that. It was either just before it or he did try out and it was just after it. He went down to retrieve someone's play toy that had been suctioned down in the air pump, the bottom of the pool, at Broderpool Pool, and it got a hold of his trunks and he drowned. I mean, tragic story,
yeah,
but awful. Fascinating story.
That was the Paris Olympics as well. Now here you are 100 years later, and that's the Paris Olympics in 2024.
40% of every dollar generated for that bad boy and those 35,000 tickets right to West 56th Street. The rich get richer.
They better not have any leaks in there because the Lucas Oil Stadium does not have a drainage system.
That's right.
They better not have any leaks.
Yeah, because in Omaha, they obviously didn't do it in a football stadium.
Can they do it roof open?
Yeah. Well, it is going to be June. They did it outside. I didn't realize this. In 2004, they did it outside in Long Beach.
Yeah. I love Long Beach.
Couldn't that impact like some of the times or some of the training? I don't think everyone is Lily King outside. I guess she trained outside in a pond and during the pandemic in Bloomington.
Maybe a bunch of chlorinated water would get that Patriots logo that's like melded on the undertow of the stadium.
Well, I know some people complain about a lot of injuries on that field. I don't know. Maybe that would help things over there. All right, we come back. We got some calls to get to here on Kevin and Querry. And again, the overtime rule proposal that has passed Hart Glenn going into the Colts Ring of Honor here in 2022, and any remaining thoughts on Jim Irsay's comments from yesterday. The sun is shining. It'll be a warm but windy one here in Indy. Kevin and Querry, 93.5, 107.5, The Fan.
When a health system treats patients with the very best in medical care and compassion, it needs a rare kind of staff. That's why Eskenazi Health never stops looking for professionals who understand that technology is most effective when paired with a genuine human touch. If you are
a nurse,
a social worker,
or another professional interested in a career with us, visit eskenazihealth.edu/careers. Eskenazi Health, one of Becker's 150 great places to work in healthcare.
Indy 11 is back for the 2022 season with the home opener on Saturday, April 2nd at 7. Having you there is what makes our game day so special. So come for the fireworks, smoke bombs, ribbon cannons, and a brand new Indy 11 checkered home kit available for purchase at shop.indy11.com. Be a part of Indy 11's Blue Out Blowout. Get your tickets now. Visit indy11.com or download the Indy 11 app. We'll see you at the mic on Saturday, April 2nd. Brought to you by your Central Indiana Honda dealers.
Spring rains are here, so make sure you get to Big O Tires to keep you and your family safe out there on the roads. Big O Tire stores are locally owned and operated, and they give you the lowest price on every tire every day. Big O Tires also has additional savings on brands that you know and trust, like up to $190 in savings plus free basic installation on sets of four in-stock Bridgestone or Firestone tires now through April the 3rd. Big O can also take care of those brakes, alignments, batteries, fluids, and more with no credit needed financing that's tailored just for you. Schedule online at BigOTires.com. Big O Tires, the team you trust.
Switch to Spectrum Mobile and get unlimited data for only $29.99 per month each when you get two or more lines. You could save hundreds on your mobile bill. Plus, there are no added taxes, hidden fees, and no contracts. Try the Spectrum Mobile Savings Calculator today, and in three easy steps, you'll see how much you could save. Visit SpectrumMobile.com/save. Offer valid for new customers on two or more unlimited lines. Spectrum Internet required. Restrictions apply. Visit SpectrumMobile.com for details.
It takes courage to talk with that someone special when there are problems in the bedroom. Erectile dysfunction, or PE, can shatter your confidence and make your relationship challenging. You can put an end to these issues. Have the courage to make just one confidential visit to the Indianapolis Men's Clinic and get that spark back in your relationship. The doctors at the Indianapolis Men's Clinic offer the latest solutions for all ED and PE issues, and you'll see results in your first visit. Or there's no charge. Call 999-9000 to meet with their licensed providers, no matter your age or your conditions. Diabetes, high blood pressure, prostate cancer, low testosterone causing your issue. It doesn't matter. They can help. Call the Indianapolis Men's Clinic at 999-9000. That's 999-9000 or online at indymensclinic.com. Have the courage to take that first step. Indianapolis Men's Clinic, your key to a better life.
Put on your helmet. It's about to get real.
Greg Cosell, what are your thoughts on Matt Ryan?
Well, Matt Ryan's a hard guy not to like. He's been a really good quarterback in this league. He's essentially a pocket player. Really smart before the snap of the ball. Understands defenses. Is not fooled very often. He's just a really good quarterback. And we'd be talking about him as a Hall of Famer if he won that Super Bowl. So Matt Ryan's a really, really good player.
Dan Dockage. Weekdays noon to 3 on 93.5 and 107.5. The Fan. You're listening to Kevin and Querry on 93.5 and 107.5. The Fan.
By the way, I did have a friend I know that part right there is shocking enough, that worked just for fun in the summertime, picked up a side gig working security at one of the music venues. And I said, oh, that's good. And I ran into this person when I was at the Third Eye Blind show. I always liked Third Eye Blind. That was a fabulous album.
Same. I saw them too. Yep.
And I said, oh, you know, what sort of things do you do? Well, I set up for the bands and da-da-da-da. Oh, cool. Who's cool and who's not? This is my favorite question to ask anywhere I go, right? Like, and he said, oh, undoubtedly the biggest prima donna's pain in the backside, Third Eye Blind.
Oh, no.
Really?
Yeah, I know.
Gosh, why'd you share that?
They are a good band. But it was really kind of a one-album band, right? They're kind of like Hootie and the Blowfish in that regard. Like, that one album was awesome, and then it's kind of like, yeah, okay.
Famous people letting people down, it can be a big, big bummer.
There was a fabulous segment on a national overnight radio show I used to listen to 25 years ago. I can't even remember the fella's name. But he used to do a segment called Tipped or Gypped, where people in the service industry would call in and tell their stories of tipped or gypped by famous people. Now, to tie it into sports, since this is a sports radio show, and we'll get Joel Erickson's going to join us at 9 o'clock. I worked at Hardwick's Pipe and Tobacco, cigar store in Broadville. Best job ever. No offense, Kevin. And from 1993 to 99 or 2000, somewhere there, I worked there, and I loved every minute of it. And there was a guy that would come in, really nice guy, who was a limo driver back when renting limos was a thing, right, before Uber and all that. And a lot of times he would pick people up and take them to a restaurant or something, and then he'd have an hour to kill, so he'd come in and hang out at the cigar store. I asked him once, I said, you know, that exact question. A basketball personality, a noted basketball personality, he said, oh, man, I'll never forget. I picked the guy up downtown, had to take him to the airport, got to the airport. He gets out of the car and says, man, I left my wallet packed in my suitcase with my money. So I'm sorry, man, I'm running, I'm late, I can't pay, like, give me your business card and I'll send you a payment. And the guy's thinking, you got to be kidding me. Totally ripped me off, right? So he gives him his business card and just kind of writes it off, forgets about it. Like 2 weeks later, gets a letter from said individual with five $100 bills in it and a note saying, be sure to call over to the Pacers because I've left you courtside tickets to the game of your choice.
Oh my.
Wow.
You want to guess who it was?
I have no idea.
Yeah, you got nothing.
Bill Walton.
Really?
Yep. The guy's like, man, couldn't have been a nicer guy. And he said, actually, the whole drive, he couldn't have been a nicer guy. Now, my buddy Mike Byron, his dad went and saw Dick Vitale speak in Bloomington 25 years ago. And at the end of the speech, Vitale goes, by the way, I need a ride back to Indy to go to the airport. So my Byron's dad, Dan Byron's like, I'll give you a ride. Said he got in the car and asked him one question on 37, and Vitale was still talking when he got to the airport.
That doesn't surprise me at all.
I was going to say, yeah, that's the easiest way to get through the 37 traffic and construction down there. The Colts passed the, or I should say, the NFL owners passed the Colts overtime rule proposal yesterday. This is for the postseason. Both teams are going to get a possession. It is sudden death. After that, the big reason for this, you had 12 playoff games in the last decade go to overtime. 10 of the 12 were won by the team that won the coin toss.
So what is the overtime change now? How is it going to work?
Regular season's still the same. Just overtime, both teams going to get a crack at it. So both teams will touch the football, and then if you're still tied after that, it becomes sudden death. So yeah, winning the coin toss will have a little bit of merit behind it. A question I have, though, is, will we see kind of teams adopt the college philosophy of, we want to start on defense because we want to know what we need to do when we get the ball?
Yeah, I would think, right?
I think a lot will depend on what just happened in regulation. You know, was your defense on the field for a 10-minute drive, something like that? But I think if all things were even, you'd probably want to send your defense out there first, right?
By the way, speaking of those games and the way they end, I can't remember now. The Kansas City Buffalo game. That was the divisional round, right? And then the AFC title game was, did the Cincinnati Kansas City game go into overtime?
Yes, Cincinnati is one of the two teams that lost the coin toss. Remember, Mahomes had those really iffy passes on that opening
drive. Got picked
And he did get picked on third down.
13 seconds into the overtime, right. And it was 13 seconds.
Could
was
have been
the
picked
big,
on first or right. second down. I think second down especially.
So my question for you is this. Does that seem long ago to you? When you think about the AFC title game, does that seem long ago to you?
In a way, yes. In a way, it seems like yesterday.
That was 59 days ago. 60 days from right now, Indianapolis 500. So that's how far away we are to the Indy 500.
I feel like once, I've been thinking about this, once you get to like, I mean, April is what, Friday?
Yeah.
Then I'm just like, blink of an eye.
But for the last week, it's been October, right?
Yeah.
Like yesterday, I walked into the grocery store and I'm looking around and I'm like, I feel like I should be going to a high school football game.
Jake, think about the weather at some of those Grand Prix two weeks before the 500.
Listen,
I have
buddy.
Sat in the stands and been freezing my you-know-what-off.
One year, because I call the Grand Prix from the basket in turn one, which is underneath the overhang, so there's no sun. I had on a full Patagonia and my Clemson snow hat and gloves, calling a race and gloves, and I'm thinking, and I'm calling the Indy 500 in 2 weeks? And then during the 500, I'm up there and it's, you know, making sure I have enough water. I mean, it's crazy. No doubt about it. Do you run the mini?
No.
Mark?
No. Come on.
What?
Got three kids. I'm running marathons in my spare time?
Minis.
Minis.
Mini? I don't care.
It's only a half marathon.
I don't.
Are you running it again this year?
No.
Me?
Yeah.
100%. Mobbin's doing it with me again.
Nice. Matt wanted to talk Colts wideouts. Matt, welcome to Kevin and Corey.
Does Ballard have this theory where he has to be the smartest guy in the room? And, like, our number two receiver, Strachan, I don't know how to say his name.
Strawn. I think it's Reggie Wayne, but yeah, Mike Strawn, technically.
Yeah. Yeah, it was definitely Reggie Wayne. He went to Charleston College, didn't look amazing, but he wouldn't take a flyer on DK Metcalf in the third round. Is he just convinced that these guys, even if they're producing at small colleges, why not take a shot at like a fifth stringer from Alabama or an SEC school who's actually played against some good competition in college?
Yeah, Matt, it's an interesting point. I think when you get to those parts of the draft, it's twofold, Jake. Are you looking at the fourth or fifth stringer, or I don't know, fourth or fifth might be a little bit too far down the depth chart, but are you looking for one of those depth guys in the SEC, or are you looking for the next Pierre Garçon? You know, small school, put up crazy numbers, and Strawn did put up some pretty impressive numbers at Charleston. Again, my issue comes back to defensive line this time last year. Ballard made a similar mistake, in my mind, to that group. But in that year, he had a Kamoko Ture, a Ben Banigou, a Tyquan Lewis, ended up drafting a Kwadipe, Dayo Odengba. Jake, those are all first and second round picks.
Right.
He doesn't have any of those in his wide receiver room. The one he does, Paris Campbell, has played in 15 football games in 3 years. So that's where I find difficulty in this. It's not necessarily who he's drafted. On day three, I mean, sure, Metcalf, I think, was taken after Paris Campbell or something along those lines. You know, hindsight, so 2020, you could do that with so many drafts. My issue comes from, it's not like you have these, you know, high-end talent guys that have been knocking on the door for 2 years, developing, and all they need is a chance.
Let me ask you, Kevin, is it possible that Chris Ballard's continued faith in the current wide receiver core of the Indianapolis Colts illuminates Chris Ballard's total lack of confidence in Carson Wentz? And I know Carson Wentz is gone, but I'm saying, is it an indictment? Is it a further indictment on Carson
yes.
Wentz?
Oh, without a doubt.
In other words, is Chris Ballard saying to himself, you know, and Chris Ballard, when it comes to the conversation when he tunes into this show, he knows
definitely
exactly.
Made me think, and I mean, Bowen, every time I freaking read or listen to Bowen, it's like a constant freaking barrage of wideouts.
Okay. So,
was he tuning in Palm Beach?
Absolutely. He listens on...
You can stream us worldwide.
He listens on the stream, that's right. But is it possible, though, that he is thinking to himself, you know, I get that people wonder why I'm high on Mike Strawn, and I'm high on Paris Campbell, and I'm high on, you know, I mean, Zach Pascal's gone now, but And he is saying to himself, people are going to find out once Matt Ryan's throwing them the ball that it's a totally different room than it was with Carson Wentz.
Definitely an indictment on Carson Wentz. And, you know, I'd said that back in January when I walked out of that Ballard press conference and he was once again very lukewarm on publicly. He talked about needs at tight end. He talked about needs at pass rush. I think corner was another need. We've seen two of those already, pass rush and corner addressed. But wide receiver, he didn't go there at all. And I'm thinking to myself, first off, me personally, I disagree with that. But my second thought was, oh, wow, if he thinks that about his wideout group, that means he thinks even worse about Carson Wentz than I thought.
Yeah, I mean, again, Reich, though, Reich has spoken favorably of the wide receiver. I think Reich has to.
But Reich...
Ballard, Reich has to, though.
Ballard's candidness is different than Reich. Reich is not Bruce Arians in front of a mic.
But and Reich's job, though, is to pump guys up, right?
Sure.
So he's got to say good things.
Yeah. I'm not really getting at the Reich comments. It's more the Ballard. Ballard typically is pretty honest with his position groups in that his actions often, you know, back up his words. But his words with wide receiver, man, they've just never been to the level that I think they should be. All right, Joel Erickson is going to join us here in about 15 minutes. Again, he was live down there at the NFL owners' meetings over the past few days, so we'll get his thoughts on more of these comments. Kevin Aquari, 93.5, 107.5, The Fan.
Every dribble, every pass, and every bucket, all in the palm of your hand, because now you can sign up and bet. No strings attached with Bet River Sportsbook app featuring award-winning customer service. Live in-game bets, player props, and instant betting bucket to bucket. Don't miss out on all the big games. Get in the action with Bet River Sportsbook app.
Must be 21. Must be located in Indiana. Gambling problem? Call 1-800-9-WITH-IT. 1-800-994-8448.
Business owners, are you feeling the pressures of running your business? There's a limit to what you can do and still keep employees engaged. Insperity brings 30-plus years of HR experience to help you with hiring, training, HR administration, and compliance while giving your employees competitive benefit options. You're able to focus on other priorities. Your employees can thrive and your business can grow. With Insperity, nothing seems impossible. Full-service HR, employee benefits, HR technology, Insperity. HR that makes a difference.
A few weeks ago, I was lucky enough to chat with the owners of Golden Oak Lending. This is no BS, but they are great people ready to help all of us in the saving money category. That's their goal. Our friends at Golden Oak Lending are ready to help right now and get you refinance today. Even if you refinance as recently as last year, Golden Oak might be able to lower your interest rate even further and put some money in your pocket. One of the many things I love about Golden Oak is no cost for an appraisal. That's right. Simply just picking up the phone, seeing if they can meet your goals costs absolutely nothing. And who you talk to will be a local loan officer right here in Indianapolis. Golden Oak's experienced local loan officers make refinancing and buying a breeze, guiding you through every step to ensure you never get lost in jargon or numbers. No matter your unique situation or goals, you have an expert lending partner for life in Golden Oak Lending. Head to goldenoaklending.com right now to see what your home equity can do for you. NMLS 114937, 3.25% fixed, 4.361% APR, FHA 15-year mortgage with 20% equity and approved credit.
Spring in Indy. And since 2001, Rhino Shield has been covering Indiana homes and businesses. Just ask Mike.
I was watching TV one night and saw the Rhino Shield ad. And I thought, well, if they can do a house, they can probably do a building.
And Rhino Shield's not paint. It's better.
So they came out and they gave me a price, showed me how the Rhino works, how it lasts, and how the guarantee works.
Business owners, you too can get the 25-year protection of Rhino Shield right now for 15% off the regular price.
They started on the building. They waited for us to leave, and they worked Saturday and Sunday, so they wouldn't affect our business at all. This was the great part of it. I came back Sunday night, and you couldn't even tell they were here. There was no paint on the ground. They did a fantastic job.
Here's owner Shane Smith.
This offer is limited, so call me at 888-RHINO-41. That's 888-RHINO-41.
Don't paint.
Don't vinyl.
Go Rhino.
Paint. Don't vinyl. Go Rhino Shield.
Never paint your house again.
Rhino Shield.
Finding great candidates to hire can be like, well, trying to find a needle in a haystack. Sure, you can post your job to some job board, but then all you can do is hope the right person comes along, which is why you should try ZipRecruiter for free at ziprecruiter.com/hire. ZipRecruiter doesn't depend on candidates finding you. It finds them for you. Its powerful technology identifies people with the right experience and actively invites them to apply to your job. You get qualified candidates fast. So while other companies might deliver a lot of hay, ZipRecruiter finds you what you're looking for. The needle in the haystack.
See why 4 out of 5 employers who post a job in ZipRecruiter get a quality candidate within the first day. ZipRecruiter, the smartest way to hire. And now you can try ZipRecruiter for free. That's right, free. At ZipRecruiter.com/hire. That's ZipRecruiter.com/hire. ZipRecruiter.com/hire.
Turn it up.
John. Greg Hubler Chevrolet proudly presents Free Sadcast. With special guests, Lone Star, Diamond Rio, Big Country, and Rose O'Neill. Saturday, June 18th at the Morgan County Fairgrounds in Martinsville. Save 25% off all tickets April 2nd, 10 a.m. to 2 p.m. only at Craig Hubler Chevrolet in Canby. Trace Adkins, Saturday, June 18th at the Morgan County Fairgrounds. More info at HankFM.com.
Soccer Saturday featuring Indy 11. If this is your football, this is your show. Saturday at 9 on The Fan.
You're listening to Kevin and Querry on 93.5 and 107.5, The Fan.
We'll get some Jim Irsay reaction from Joel Erickson for the Indianapolis Star. He was down at the owners' meetings in Palm Beach here in about 10 minutes. Looking forward to that conversation. We just touched on it briefly earlier, Jake. Tarik Glenn going to the Colts Ring of Honor. You know, without Marvin Harrison and Tarik Glenn in place, you think Peyton finds a level of success that he did? Particularly so quickly. Obviously, the rookie season struggles, but then 13-3 that second season.
You know, Marvin Harrison, it's interesting because he had a separated shoulder for the better part of Manning's rookie year, and Torrance Small was kind of Manning's safety net in the beginning. But God, then, yeah, having Harrison, boy, that, and, you know, I think the most underrated or underappreciated aspect or tool that Peyton Manning had for comfort in the early years, quite frankly, Kevin, to answer your question, in Glenn's case, no. I mean, that was a critical piece. Would Peyton Manning still have found his foot? Yeah, it's Peyton Manning, right? But
I just think you take for granted
no
Glenn
question.
Being there.
No question. And I do think that we take for granted as well the fact that Edgerrin James was as good a blitz blocking and reading back as you'll find in the NFL.
Tarik Glenn, 10 seasons, 9 of 10 he played every single game. So that availability. That's
pretty impressive.
Where do you think next for the Colts Ring of Honor?
One of two guys. Is Sanders in there?
No.
I'd say it's one of two guys, and they're both from Iowa. Sanders or Clark. Is Clark in?
I thought he might be.
I don't think Clark is in. I think Sanders gets in because, and you could make the argument that Bob Sanders was, that his window was too short. But, I mean, look, Eric Dickerson wasn't here very long and had – Eric Dickerson's impact was different. I personally think Dickerson is more than justified in being in there. Marshall Faulk, you know, wasn't a very long time. Bob Sanders
– yeah, Dallas is not in there.
Yeah, so Bob Sanders was – he absolutely brought a tone. The most underrated aspect of that Super Bowl run to me, and he's not a Ring of Honor guy, Booger McFarland was the missing piece. When they plugged in Booger McFarland from a defensive standpoint, that was the final piece that cemented everything for that defense that came together during that run. But Bob Sanders was the fan favorite, set the tone, muscle on muscle. He was the face of that run.
If you're going in order of playing, those two would make sense. The only other one that probably is a little bit more of a slam dunk lock, I think, is Vinatieri.
Well, yeah, I mean...
But again, if you go in order, obviously Clark or Sanders.
Does Brackett eventually get in?
God, I don't think so.
Again,
I mean, it's
Brackett was one of those that's a bigger player here than he was in totality. Like, in other words...
Sure.
You know what I mean? Like, when I worked in St. Louis, I was stunned to find out that Willie McGee was the most popular Cardinal. Not, I mean, you know, obviously like Lou Brock, Bob Gibson, but, you know, of the
every
of the 80s
fan
teams,
base has their guy.
Right. And Brackett's kind of that guy, or was during his playing time.
I know Gino had a couple of questions that I wanted to get to. He's been hanging on for a while. Gino, welcome to Kevin and Query.
What's going on, guys? How are you?
Good. Yourself?
I'm good. So, yeah, you're right. Just a couple questions. Number one is, I'm going to hang up and listen, but how does the draft situation work for the Pacers with the trade with LeVert? I heard Jake earlier say that it was like a protected lottery. So with the Pacers pick and the Cavaliers pick, like, to me, I'm like, I didn't think we had two lottery picks. So I was just curious there. And then also, if Colts do sign, end up signing, you know, the Honey Badger, what does that do for Julian Blackman? I mean, would they switch him to strong safety? Would they, you know, put him as a rotation guy?
Well, they'd make sure he's healthy first, right?
True. Right.
Yeah, I think two very good questions, Gino. Let's start with that Colts one. I don't know exactly how it would work with Julian Blackman, Kari Willis, and Tyrann Mathieu. I feel like Willis might be the odd man out there. But I look at it as, Jake, you play so much nickel in today's NFL, five defensive backs. It's pretty much your starting lineup. So you would want Mathieu, Honey Badger, and Willis on the field, I think, for large portions of a game. So I don't know exactly. It's a great question. We'll see if it's something that needs to be addressed.
My buddy Steve is a diehard Chiefs fan. You guys can have Honey Badger. I think he's run out of his time with the Chiefs. He's getting a little bit of attitude, but he does seem a little bit slower. That's just one of those positions where you can fall off a cliff. You know what I mean?
Yeah, his playmaking was still pretty high last year. You know, he was all pro 2 years ago. I get it. You know, he turns 30 in May. I'm not acting like it's a long-term thing, but I do think it can help you out. Especially that secondary doesn't have a whole lot of experience. You got Kenny Moore, but not a lot of experience around that.
In terms of the draft pick explanation, pretty simple. If Cleveland falls out of the playoffs and goes into the lottery, it's a lottery protected pick, so Cleveland retains the pick. And therefore, the Colts get one more chance next year of getting the first pick, getting a first round pick if Cleveland falls out of the lottery. Otherwise, it then becomes a second round pick the year after that. Right?
Yeah, it cannot be a lottery pick, I guess.
Correct.
To Geno's point. Right now, the Cavs are the seventh team in the Eastern Conference. That means they'd be in the play-in format. If they make the playoffs, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, any of those seeds, the Pacers will get that pick. Which, what'd you say, Jake? It was like 19th last you saw?
Yes, correct.
If they don't make the playoffs, then it gets pushed to next year when it is again lottery protected. So that means the Cavs retain it if they don't make the playoffs. So Pacers fans wanting this pick right now, right here, should want Cleveland in the playoffs. If it goes 2 years, then it transitions to multiple second-round picks, which is certainly what you don't want there. So I know that's a little confusing. Basically, if you want the pick this year, cheer for Cleveland to make the playoffs. Isn't it crazy you could have Brooklyn and L.A. miss the playoffs?
Yeah, that'd be fabulous, actually. Right.
Yeah, that would be. Well, unless you work at...
Would anybody outside of Brooklyn or L.A. care?
I was going to say, unless you work at the league office or Turner or...
That's true.
You know, ESPN. All right, we come back. Joel Erickson from the Star is going to join us. We see good Jimmy and training camp Jimmy, shockingly, on the line here. We'll try to get to those a little bit later as well. But Joel Erickson from the Star joins us next here on Kevin and Query, 93.5, 107.5, The Fan.
The biggest piece to the puzzle is in place.
Matt Ryan and the Colts.
How good is Matt Ryan?
What pieces fall next?
Irsay says all in, that this team couldn't do all in.
I don't think they have the weapons enough to be really good.
So what are you going after?
When the puzzle's completed.
The Colts have
wide receivers.
A definitive need right there.
At a very high level.
You will hear about it here on your home for Colts football.
You can sit here, bitch, whine, and moan every day, and you know I will.
93.5 and 107.5, The Fan.
Big O Tires is locally owned and operated with the lowest price on every tire every day, plus online appointment scheduling and financing made easy. Big O Tires, the team you trust.
There's never been a better time for a cash out refinance. Apply online today at thehomeloanexpert.com.
NMLS number 1326241.
At Gainbridge Fieldhouse, we protect home court.
That's blocked again by Turner.
We battle.
Washington drives, scores, and a foul.
We dig deep.
Nice pass, Brissett.
For tip-off through the final buzzer. It's game time at the Fieldhouse.
It's one of your last chances to cheer on the blue and gold when the Denver Nuggets come to town. Catch the Pacers and Nuggets Wednesday at 7. Get your tickets at Pacers.com. That's Pacers.com. Pacers Nuggets Wednesday at 7.
You found the one? Now find the ring. Come to Shane Company. Our team of jewelry consultants will do whatever it takes to help you find the perfect engagement ring. Not only are we knowledgeable about diamonds and sapphires, ring settings, and financing options, but we're problem solvers, too. Just the other day, a guy came in who wanted to surprise his girlfriend with a spectacular engagement ring, but he wasn't certain what style she would like. So, we came up with a great solution. Get a classic solitaire diamond ring for the proposal. Then, set up an appointment to come back as a couple and create her dream ring. He did just that. He selected a 1.25-carat oval diamond and had it set in a solitaire ring setting. Then, after the proposal, he and his fiancée came back together and swapped it for a pave ring setting and added a halo decorative crown to give it even more sparkle. When she put it on, she was beaming. He pulled off an amazing proposal, and she got the ring of her dreams.
Now you have a friend in the jewelry business. Shane Company and ShaneCo.com.
We buy any car. We buy any car. We buy any car. Any.
Did you know trading in your car at a dealer could cost you money? A recent study found consumers who trade in their car pay an average of $990 more. So don't trade in. Sell it to We Buy Any Car. Learn more and get your free online valuation now at WeBuyAnyCar.com.
Find out how much your car's worth at WeBuyAnyCar.com.
93.5 and 107.5, The Fan.
WIBC HD2, W298BB, WIBC HD3, W228CX, Indianapolis.
Join me today, Seth Greenberg. Talk Final Four as we move towards New Orleans. Also, Ryan Burry, he'll talk Final Four. He'll give you some golfers and just basically talk. Join me noon to 3 today.
You're listening to Kevin and Querry on 93.5 and 107.5, The Fan.
It is 9 o'clock, technically 9:01 in Indianapolis on a Wednesday. It is 9:01 everywhere in the Eastern time zone, for that matter. My name is Jake Querry, Kevin Bowen, the other voice you hear on this program. Mark Dykton is the man flying the Millennium Falcon here for us. Joining us now on the Payless Liquors Hotline, he is with the Indianapolis Star. Joel Erickson joins us to talk about the Colts. Joel, we'll get right to this point. We've talked a lot this morning about Jim Irsay's comments from down in Florida. Was there anything he said that stood out to you as surprising or particularly noteworthy?
A lot of it, I think, probably, especially the Wentz stuff, was sort of startling in its, I guess, starkness, like the fact, like what he said. Like, I think we kind of knew a lot of that stuff. I guess. Not surprising in terms of how the team thinks or anything like that, but I think most people were probably a little bit surprised by just like how willing he was to be open about what he thought on Carson Wentz.
Yeah, he certainly didn't hold back. I tweeted out last night, my goal in this professional life is hopefully to have an owner that doesn't talk about me, as Jim Irsay's talked about Carson Wentz. One question I want to ask you, Joel, and again, Joel Erickson from The Star, who, are you still in Palm Beach?
No, I am. I was supposed to be back last night, and then my connecting flight left without me.
Oh,
so I left from Tampa at 5:45 this morning, and I am just now getting back to Fishers. So I'm back, but it took a little bit.
Well, doing 3 hours with Jake when he's had barely any sleep, I greatly appreciate you doing that with us. There was a quote yesterday, and I've got it right here. It says, and this is from Irsay. Sometimes you feel like you have to move on because you can't persuade people to do things different if they don't want to do them differently. Percentage of that rooted in Carson Wentz's vaccine decision, and percentage of that rooted in, I don't know, an unwillingness to change his playing style or accept coaching?
Stephen Holder from The Athletic actually clarified that when that quote happened, and he was talking about the football stuff from a football perspective of just, you know, not being able to change his style or
you know, play within Frank's offense was what he meant. It was a good clarification by Steven to kind of jump in and make sure. But yeah, it was talking about the football. I mean, the stuff he wouldn't, the stuff he couldn't or wouldn't or didn't do that Reich was trying to get him to do to help get his game to a different level.
Who do you think that other quarterback was that Irsay was talking about? And correct if I'm wrong, I think he mentioned to you guys two first-round picks he was willing to give up. I know Jake maybe thought Deshaun Watson. I threw out Kyler Murray. Anybody you would throw out as to who that possibly could have been?
So I'll throw a couple people out. Well, like Watson was three first-rounders, so at least two Kess makes me wonder if he's talking about that. And then Kyler fits, obviously, because of all that stuff, that the weird thing that him and the Cardinals did back and forth. I know Derek Carr isn't considered a young quarterback by us, but he's probably got 8-9 years left, so maybe that could have been it. The stuff that I'm trying to figure out is he said at least two first rounders, at least two ones, which, I mean, Russell Wilson went for way more than that, and so did Watson. So you got to maybe bring it down a little bit. And then the other thing that I can't figure out what he might be hinting at was he said that something else needed to happen to make that guy available. And I don't know what that something else is.
So I guess Baker's out of the question, right?
I think they might have got it. At this point, they might get a pick for Baker. So
I know.
He definitely wouldn't have cost
that
least,
was,
he definitely would have cost at least two runs.
Definitely being facetious there. Joel, the other thing that I thought was interesting was, you know, we talked about this earlier, but I wanted your feedback on it. When you look at Chris Ballard and, for that matter now, Frank Reich's insistence that they could be okay at receiver with the current core, is that their way of subconsciously saying, now that we have a guy to get them the ball where it needs to be? Is that an indictment further on Carson Wentz, which at this point is probably an indictment they need to move on from?
I don't know if either of them are consciously trying to say that, but I also think that there's the unspoken part of that. Because I haven't gotten to these quotes yet, but there was a lot of talk about Nyheim Hines and needing to do more in the offense and with him. And I've kind of said all along, the play call, Nyheim's pass-catching production has gone up and down in his Colts career, and it's been the same play caller the whole time. It's been different quarterbacks. I don't think Frank Reich just decided not to use Nyheim Hines. I think that's a quarterback thing. And so I think you're right. I think that some of that is, you know, the they weren't getting in the ball. You know, Chris said at one point in Florida this week, Frank's offense gets guys open. And if it's got guys open and the quarterback's not hitting them, then their production goes down. So I do think that there is a part of it that has to do with that.
He's Joel Erickson from the Indianapolis Star. Great coverage all week. You can find up on IndyStar.com from the owners' meetings down in Palm Beach. Joel, you didn't sit in on this interview. It was J.J. Stankovic with Irsay. I'm not sure if you've seen it yet, but if you haven't, we're going to play this brief clip, and then I'll ask you a couple things off it. This was Irsay again with Colts.com talking about a potential defensive free agent name.
We could have, there could be, it would have to be at the right price because we don't have much cap room. In addition, you know, that excites some. But we'll see. You know, it's possible. I know Chris Ballard's looking hard at that, you know, trying to find the right, you know, individual. But it has to be the right guy at the right number, you know. But one more veteran possibly to come in and make a big difference.
Okay, two questions for you, Joel, off that. One, don't they have more than $20 million in cap space right now? And then two, is he talking about the Honey Badger?
So, yes, they have the third most cap space according to the NFLPA. I just looked that up last night because it's in the thing I wrote about All Chips In. the Colts, a lot of it has to do with, and Kevin sort of hinted at this when I've been on before, a lot of it has to do with the way the Colts approach the cap. The Colts approach it as more of a hard and fast number than other teams do. $23 million to a different team is like three big signings, honestly,
right,
or four, depending on how you structure the contract. The way the Colts operate, typically, they don't push a lot of money into future years, that kind of thing. You can make the case that that money could go pretty quickly if they make some signings and stuff. If you're not doing anything to push stuff into future years when the cap's going to rise, that's typically not the way the Colts have done it. So there is definitely a difference there between, I think Irsay speaks from the Colts perspective, which includes his own, instead of the NFL, the way NFL's gone with like the Saints and Rams and some of these teams pushing stuff into the other thing. As far as the Honey Badger goes, I think that it being a player in the secondary is pretty obvious, and he's the biggest name out there, right? Like, is there anybody else?
I can't think of the other name I thought of was maybe Stephon Gilmore.
Okay. Yeah, somebody in the secondary is what I think, because I asked Ballard in our meeting with him, I said, you guys lost Rhodes and you lost Carey. You didn't have depth at safety last year. There's not a whole lot of veteran depth there. Are we going to see a move there? And he said, "They're one of those could be coming." So I think a secondary player for sure is probably what he's talking about. You're right. We weren't in on that part. That was just with Colts.com. He didn't mention that when he talked to us.
Do you think when he says, Joel Erickson, when Jim Irsay says, I know Chris Ballard's looking at that, is that Jim Irsay giving us a glimpse into Chris Ballard, or is that Jim Irsay sending the dog whistle to Chris Ballard of, I certainly hope you're looking at this?
Oh, no. The way I would read that is that they're already in contact with the player, would be the way I read it.
Gotcha.
It's like when he says he's looking at it, it's they're in the mix, and they're waiting for a decision or whatever. Because most of these pursuits have been started for a while now. These guys have known they're going to be free agents and stuff like that. So there's been contact for a while. So that's how I'd read that.
He's Joel Erickson again from the Indianapolis Star and was down at the owners' meetings and has had a early morning, to say the least. So appreciate the time, Joel. Just a couple more here. I think one of our listeners, Jim, asked me this earlier. I wanted to throw it at you. Again, it's very rare, I think, to hear an owner make the comments that Jim Irsay continues to make about Carson Wentz. He's extremely upset about it. Given that, you would think that he'd be upset at the decision makers for making said move, i.e. Chris Ballard and Frank Reich. But based off the impression you got yesterday, is it fair to say you sense that Jim Irsay is not putting these two on any sort of a hot seat entering the 2022 season?
No, I don't think so. What he spoke about with Frank and Chris, I'm going to write something on those comments later today. What he talked about with Frank and Chris was that, he acknowledged that, there are some mistakes from those guys. But he said when he looks at the way they handle their jobs, conflict resolution, how they lead, the path they have the team on, he's on board with all of it. And the other thing he said was that in talking to other people around the league, he knows how respected Chris Ballard and Frank Reich are. And that carries a lot of weight with him. We're at the owners' meetings. We got him at the end of the owners' meetings, essentially, so I'm sure that some of those conversations had just happened. Some of them are probably conversations he has throughout the year, but he's behind those two. I think sometimes when he said all chips in, I think a lot of us sort of thought that Irsay was sort of moving away from patience, but he talked about patience a ton yesterday in terms of free agency, in terms of franchise building, in terms of finding the next franchise quarterback, the Matt Ryan search. And so I think it's important to maybe, at least for me, to realign my brain on that and say, okay, he said all chips in, but he was sort of talking about something intangible there. The patience, he probably has more patience, I think, and believes in a patient approach more than other organizations.
How did he look, Jim Irsay, just in terms of his energy, his health? How did he look?
Oh, really good. Really good. I think he said he was playing 18, doing a bunch of stuff. So he was in good shape.
It's like Tiger Woods, right?
Yeah, well, I think Tiger was walking. I'm going to go out on a limb and say Jim probably wasn't walking 18 yesterday. What are the owners' meetings like, Joel? I mean, I was trying to describe them a bit for Jake. I don't know if Jake would love just the snobby bouginess that goes on at said owners' meetings. There was a few years ago where Mike Wells, Stephen Holder, and I went on Irsay's yacht. I thought it was called Kanye earlier in the week. Someone corrected me and said it was called Usher. I think it had to do with Usher, the musician. And we all had to take our shoes off. It was one of those yachts. I don't know if Pete Ward knew like how to open every door. It was just one of those really just high-end, don't touch anything. What are the owners' meetings like nowadays?
There definitely is, like, just the fact that it's held at the Breakers. I will admit that I told Steven when I walked in the first day, I saw him, and I was like, you know, there's a 16-year-old version of me running around chasing cows that got out of our fences that doesn't have any concept of this. Like, this building, the trees, like, the cars going past, no concept of that. So there is sort of an element to that. I would say that the thing I just kept thinking was, it was just such a, there were long days. I mean, the coaches start talking at 7:45, and, you know, it's really hard to get hotels for anything remotely resembling a decent price in spring break in, you know, South Florida. So, I was leaving my hotel at, 6:30 to make it there. And then, basically, you're just on until 11, and some of it is waiting, but a lot of it is just you're waiting for these conversations that you just don't get to have very often, where you get to sit down and ask a lot of questions. The biggest thing I took away from it, and it might have to do with what happened with my plane last night, is just really long days.
Joel, we'll end with this. In my eyes, in some order, I view wideout, tight end, left tackle, and let's just say defensive back as four needs that are somewhat pressing to varying degrees for the Colts here in 2022. In the Colts' eyes, Ballard, Reich, Irsay, how do you think they would rank or view wide receiver, tight end, left tackle, and defensive back?
I would say,
not in that order is what I'm guessing. I don't think wide receiver would be first.
I think I would put receiver first, but I think that they're looking at the draft. That was the impression I got coming away from it.
I mean, it's a receiver deep draft, is it not?
It feels like every draft now is a receiver deep draft.
Yeah,
like,
Kevin was saying that.
He does like crazy. But yes, it is. It's supposed to be a very receiver deep draft. Ballard said at one point, finding an explosive receiver in the draft, we think that's doable. That I felt like was an important little sentence in there. And then I would probably go defensive back right now, and then tight end, and then maybe after that left tackle. But I don't know that you're going to see, outside of the one signing that Irsay's talking about there, I don't know that those are going to be addressed in free agency. I think it's more likely that you see him in the draft. Them bringing back Pryor and expecting him to start sort of hints to me that, like, if they think there's a developmental left tackle, they'll draft him. And Pryor's there to give him time to develop if he needs it.
Sounds like the combine's coming back here for a year.
That was the rumblings around there. That was the rumblings around there, which is surprising because it was sort of left for dead,
right,
for the last year or so. That was another thing. Irsay was very, I mean, he's always been very defensive of Indianapolis and its place there.
Oh, yeah.
But there's some comments from him that I haven't gotten to yet on the combine and what it means to Indianapolis and what he has said to Goodell basically saying that he's gone up to Goodell and said, this isn't fair. It's not fair for you to take this tradition away from us when we do it so well. But it did. It did. Like the rumblings around there were that it was going to come back. The city, Pete Ward said the city is submitting its official bid today.
Gotcha.
So,
in Dallas and L.A., is that right?
Yeah, and it sounds like there's renewed hope that it might not be gone away just yet.
Talking about the combine leaving Indy, a tradition unlike any other, right?
Pretty much. Irsay said even if it does leave, he wants to make sure they get it once every 3 years.
Yeah, I think that makes a lot of sense. I'm glad Irsay standing on a table for that. I think it's smart by him, and I think a lot of people around the league would actually agree with him. Maybe even people in Dallas and LA. Certainly,
everybody who's not an owner, every right. GM, every coach, every scout would prefer it stays at Indy, but the owners and the commissioner's office have a different idea.
Joel, I don't know if a nap is in your future. Jake will certainly make sure to cross that off the list for you.
Hell yeah.
In all seriousness, great coverage all week long. I know you came on, I think, yesterday with Derek, so thanks for making time for us this morning.
Yeah, you bet. Thanks for having me on, guys.
Joel A. Erickson right there from the Indianapolis Star. Again, his coverage over on the Star's website. Let's sneak in Good Jimmy. We're going to play Mike DeCourcy. If you missed that interview at the start of the show, we're going to play that to end the show. I know Good Jimmy had some thoughts on the Colts offseason.
We have to clarify that this is Good Jimmy.
I mean, the other Jimmy
training
is,
camp Jimmy, right?
You know, we probably should clarify the two Bills. Have we heard from either of the Bills we had on Friday?
No.
Either. Good Jimmy, 1 week away from the Masters. Welcome.
Good morning, guys. Thanks for clarifying, and please tell people around me I'm Good Jimmy also.
Will do.
Hey, real quick, two things I want to get off my chest, and then a Colts point. First, Kevin, I'm really excited. I don't know about you, but all this Tiger Woods news has me a little nervous. Obviously, I'd love to see Tiger play, but if he's going to go out there and play one or two rounds and not play very well, I'm not looking forward to that. I don't know about you, but what are your thoughts on Tiger playing? And then two more things real quick, and then I'll get you guys' take. I'm really excited to see Joker play tonight for the Nuggets. I think unfortunately now Pacers games have come down to who's on the other team.
Correct.
And watching them play. So I'm really looking forward to seeing Jokic play. And last thing, I really would be interested if you guys, I have a guest suggestion for you guys, and not to make Mark do more work, but I think it would be great for the listeners and for myself if you guys had a weekly segment with Taylor Tannenbaum. I think she did a great job with 13, and I just love her perspective. And even though she's a Florida State Seminole, and I'm a
she is a Knoll
fan, yeah.
I'll put it past her. So. But you guys have a great day. Thank you. Take care.
Thank you, Jimmy, and thank you to Taylor. She actually spoke to my class down at IU yesterday. Annually, she's always one of the favorites. So candid, and really appreciated her doing that. It's funny he mentions, you know, now that you're looking at the visiting players that are available each night for Pacer games. Jake, Corey Kenny, a big-time listener to the station, goes, I'm taking my daughter to her first Pacer game tonight. I'm trying to figure out how to explain to her that we want them to lose and not win. Good luck.
Yeah, you know? I mean, by the way, I'll be there Sunday, Jimmy.
I tried to do that with my nephew, and he looked at me cross-eyed the other night. But yeah, it does look like Jokic is indeed going to play. As far as Tiger, I understand. The expectations, Jimmy, probably not going to be very high on him to win if he indeed tees it up. But, Jake, I just want to see peg in the ground for him on Thursday and see him attempting.
Hey, you called it, though, yesterday. You were tracking that flight, stalking him.
Stalking him.
In fact, he was there, right?
You know, our country, I think, can make us mad for a lot of reasons, Jake, but the creepiness we have towards athletes in moments like that, it did give me a reassurance of, like, you know what? There's a lot of good in this world. People tracking Tiger's plane right now. Now, why couldn't we have gotten somebody in the woods at Augusta National to maybe film some of the shots?
By the way, I'm looking at the YouTube page, and my camera is totally off. And I look good today.
Yeah, you do have a nice
I've messed look. Around with it, too. I've unplugged it. I've turned it back on. Nothing.
Again, I think it's the mole police.
Somebody, that's right. Jimmy, negative.
I want Tiger to play, though. I want him to play. Again, that's me speaking purely as a fan. Moves the needle. If he doesn't play well, so be it. But you know how Tiger's wired. This event means more than anything to him. If he's able to walk 18 holes and get it around that place to the level that he thinks he can, you know, use his wisdom there and compete, he's going to try and do it.
If you get 4 days of Tiger Woods at the Masters, is that better than the first 4 days of the tournament?
For Kevin Bowen, yes.
Mm.
This from Spencer on the YouTube chat. Query, you wore out Carson Wentz for being selfish, not a true leader, and for not being vaccinated. You're the absolute worst. Spencer, man, don't shoot the messenger. I'm just telling you, I've said from the beginning that was an issue with Jim Irsay, and then he basically came out and confirmed exactly that, and you can do one of two things. You can either call me the worst, or you can say, you know what, maybe this dude knows what he's talking about. It's cool.
One quick comment on that, Jake. Do you find it odd at all? And I trust me, I know what quarterback means in the NFL. Do you find it odd at all? He's willing to give Darius Leonard the contract extension he gave. He's willing to give Quentin Nelson the contract extension that he will give him. Two unvaccinated players that obviously perform at a much better level than Carson Wentz.
No, but I think,
do you think any of that is a double standard?
Yes. But I think that he is also somebody who, as an owner in the NFL, knows that the most important position and the one that that requires 100% reliability is the quarterback position. And he is further, speaking of, as I'm talking about Jim Irsay here, further convinced of that after seeing what great quarterback play can do for you, because he had it with Peyton Manning. And so therefore, Peyton Manning set a precedent that's going to be very hard for any quarterback to live up to.
On sports care level 1 to 10, how much do you care if Tiger Woods plays in the Masters?
1-0.
Gosh, man, that breaks my heart. Yeah.
Sorry, Mark, to break it to you.
Gosh.
I like the Masters. I
just do it for me. Maybe a 4?
I mean, you
have pity points? Make our bond a little stronger. We're together in this. We're a team. Jake supports my fandom.
1 to 10 scale, how important is it for you to see Fernando Alonso run the Indy 500?
Oh, actually, it's pretty high.
Really? Okay.
I want storylines.
Okay.
I'm a big story. That's why I'm, you know, Duke Carolina in the Final Four, not the end of the world.
This is the thing. This is the beauty of sport. The beauty of sport, to a great extent, is that sports is about the pursuit of the nostalgia of our childhood. Why do you want your team to win a Super Bowl? Because you remember what the thrill of high-fiving your dad as a kid when they won a big game, and you want to recapture that high. And why do we fall in love? Why does everybody automatically think that retro uniforms are the coolest? Because it reminds them of the first time they saw it on their lunchbox. Sports is about childhood nostalgia. And there are not a lot of areas where the age difference between the two of us comes into play, except for that Tiger Woods is younger than I and older than you. And so therefore, he does represent to you a nostalgia of your sports childhood. And I respect the heck out of that. I totally get it. You know, if I could watch Jimmy Connors play the U.S. Open, it'd be pretty cool to me. You probably wouldn't care, right? Because that's what I saw as a kid. So it's all relative. I totally understand where you're coming from. Totally understand.
Yeah. Now, you and Tiger aren't that far off in age. I mean, how old were you in 97? No.
Well, but my point being, I was already an adult. I mean, I was 25.
Yeah. And so, obviously, you don't like golf, so I totally get that.
I don't dislike golf.
Yet. And you're going to like it.
What I'm saying is, Tiger Woods' era of dominance, and it was dominance, came during a time when I already had conditioned myself to a sports objectivity because I was covering it as opposed to still, like, in fandom. And I know that sounds snobbish.
Yeah, I'm whimpering inside.
My apologies.
We're going to give away a 4-pack to the Indy 11.
I like Perkins. Does that...
Opener. Oh. God, that was a shot at Tiger, wasn't it? Jeez. They do have great breakfast menus.
And they have good pies.
Yeah. Tiger off the course. Oh, boy. Yeah. Hope Rosie doesn't find one of those. okay. Again, we'll give away a 4-pack to the Indy 11 home opener. I guess the season opener against the LA Galaxy coming up on the pop quiz.
LA Galaxy 2.
LA
Electric
Galaxy
Boogaloo.
Two. Yeah, thank you for that. The sequel, as Mark said yesterday. So does that mean David Beckham's son is on the team or something like that?
Probably. Brooklyn Beckham is out there somewhere.
Let's hit a Big O Tire Sports Center update.
The Sports Center update on 93.5 and 107.5 The Fan is presented by Big O Tires, the team you trust.
By the way, Joe Hall, who I love, says Jake has no concept of golf. It's totally inaccurate. But my dad's a huge golfer.
Well, I'd say Tiger.
I went with my dad to the, what was it, Crooked Stick, like 3 years ago?
Yeah, the BMW.
Yeah, I mean, I went with my dad to that. I mean, you know.
Yeah,
I watch the Masters. I do. I just.
The concept of golf is relatively easy. In more ways than one, Tiger has mastered getting a ball into a.
Correct.
You know.
Oh, my.
I stopped. I didn't go all the way there. You in the building tonight at Gamebridge, you said, or Sunday?
Sunday.
Tonight, it is Nikola Jokic and the Denver Nuggets. They also have Boogie Cousins on their team. Boogie Cousins really has made the stops around the league after being like...
And you know what? He puts up decent numbers when he's healthy.
Talent. Just health. You know, right. Towards Achilles and all that. So
he's becoming the NBA's version of Edwin Jackson, who was on like 20 MLB teams. That's what Boogie Cousins is becoming.
Gosh, forgot about him. 45-31, the Nuggets are the sixth seed out west right now. The Pacers 25-51, six to go. I was thinking about this yesterday, Jake. It really is a shame how this Pacers season has gone, considering how the thud of the end of the Colts season, the thud of the end of the Indiana season, same thing for Purdue. This would be such a golden time for the Pacers to be making one of those potential playoff
runs.
Credit
to the Pacers. They didn't build us up and then just completely pull the rug out from underneath us, right?
Yeah. I would say by what? Thanksgiving, we knew this is where things were heading for this Pacers
season. It's interesting because for as bad as they are, and they're historically bad, they're still kind of interesting.
Yeah, they don't get... Well, lately they've kind of gotten run out of the gym a few times. But for the most part, they weren't getting like absolutely... smoke night in, night out, but now they are in full tank mode here with six to go. Final Four, looking forward to Saturday again. Mike DeCourcy is going to join us here in about 15 minutes. Villanova and Kansas 6:09, Duke Carolina 8:49. Either of those spreads surprise you? 4.5 points, I think I've seen for both. Kansas favored and Duke favored.
Kansas, I probably would give, I think I'd credit to Villanova and just what they do in Jay Wright because they're banged up. And Kansas is really good. I would think that'd be more like 5 or 6, maybe, but no. Carolina Duke. Can Carolina do it again after they spoil Krzyzewski's swan song?
Boy, those totally different environment for those Duke kids. I mean, all the hubbub and hype towards that. Obviously, the Final Four has its own hype.
I went to the 92 Final Four, and there were a bunch of people in the hotel wearing T-shirts that said, "Welcome to the Duke Invitational."
No, oh, jeez.
Yeah.
Duke does make it puke, kind of. Duke no is question. Notre Dame football for a lot of people.
Yes.
Okay, totally.
That is correct.
Okay, your level of fandom, you said, is a 0 for Tiger Woods potentially playing the Masters. Your level of intrigue on the U.S. men's national team potentially qualifying for the World Cup tonight would be?
Well, it's a foregone conclusion. I get it. 3.
Oh, a little higher?
Yeah. I mean...
Is that global interest? Is that is that patriotism?
I like the World Cup. I think it's cool. I do find myself rooting for like second and third world nations in the World Cup because I know what it means to those countries to have a hope or something to be proud of. So I'd like to see the U.S. involved in it.
During the NFL season, though, this year, the World Cup.
That's
not great planning.
You know, I do...
But I guess Qatar, you're at the mercy of their weather.
The one thing that I will say, in a very unpopular opinion, maybe I shouldn't say it, I am patriotic enough to root for the U.S. men's team in the World Cup despite not being a huge soccer fan, although I'm growing an appreciation for it. But I'm patriotic enough to both do that and also to feel uncomfortable when guys wear American flags like a cape.
Yeah, I gotcha. Okay. That makes sense.
You shouldn't be using it as a bath towel.
Right.
It's a flag.
Yeah. No, that makes total sense. Again, Costa Rica tonight in Costa Rica. Was it San Jose, San Juan? Did we ever
San Jose, I think is right.
San Jose.
Is it San Jose?
I didn't
look
it up. You
were supposed to look that up,
I
Mark.
Didn't look it up.
Mark's got a lot on his plate. You just heard, you know, Jimmy, you know, asking him to
be doing
call in guests all of a sudden.
I'm balancing guests.
Yeah.
People still want animal sounds.
I was going to say, we haven't heard any peacock noises, thankfully.
Well, no, we've retired that. That one is put to bed, but we didn't ban the other ones.
Retired. Well, thankfully, it's well over a break here on Kevin and Query. Four-pack of Indy 11 tickets given away on the pop quiz. We had a winner Monday, almost a winner yesterday. You said there's one about the 82-year anniversary of something?
Yeah. Get out your history books, folks.
So our geriatric calls will be coming next here. 317-239-1070 for the pop quiz and Indy 11 tickets.
Springtime in Indy. The home really took a hit this winter. Rhino Shield. Call 888-RHINO-41. That's 888-RHINO-41. So don't paint, don't vinyl, go Rhino.
If you love listening to our shows, then you've got to follow us on our social media. You can find us on Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, and YouTube. Search 107.5 The Fan and share your opinions with us on our posts.
When it comes to your credit card, Discover believes in having real people available 24/7 to help answer your questions. Discover. Exceptionally common sense.
Stop by one of your locally owned and operated Big O Tire stores in Mooresville, Plainfield, Lebanon, Brownsburg, Whitestown, and Indy at 86 and Zionsville Road now through April the 3rd and get up to $190 in savings plus free basic installation on sets of four select in-stock Bridgestone or Firestone tires. Big O has the lowest price on every tire every day with no credit needed financing for every situation. Big O is more than just tires too. Come in for brakes, alignments, oil changes, fluids, batteries, and more. Schedule your appointment at BigOtires.com. That's Big O Tires, the team you trust.
Start a new career with a job that keeps your community safe. The Marion County Sheriff. Carrie Forrestal is hiring detention deputies to work in the brand new Community Justice Center. You'll supervise and guard offenders, making Marion County a better place to live. Starting pay begins at around $40,000 a year with a $5,000 signing bonus. Enjoy great benefits like complete health coverage and pension plan. Start your career as a detention deputy and earn the respect of your community. Apply today at joinmcso.indy.gov.
Trading in or selling your car, truck, or SUV? WeBuyAnyCar.com takes the hassle out of selling in just three easy steps. One, get your free online valuation. Two, drive to your local car buying center. And three, walk out with your check in as little as 30 minutes. So don't wait. Get your free online valuation now at WeBuyAnyCar.com.
Find out how much your car's worth at WeBuyAnyCar.com.
Business catering doesn't have to be boring. In fact, it shouldn't be. Whether you're looking for box lunches with fresh wraps, taco bars with all the fixings, or our signature smoky barbecue, Nameless Catering is ready to take your team lunch to the next level. Nameless Catering prides itself on being flexible and affordable for corporate catering options. Small to large, we do it all. Visit namelesscatering.com for more information and to request a same-day response.
Hey, it's Stan Dockich here with my wife, the lovely Lee Ross. Lee, we've had several jobs done at our house by the Michalis Corporation. You've dealt with them way more than I did. You know, I forget everything. Remind me, what was the scheduled work they did and how'd it go?
They were great to work with. Michalis rebuilt a roof over our sunroom and a structure over our two-story deck so we could sit outside on the lower level even when it's raining. The ladies at the office kept me informed every step of the way, and Michalis did everything they said they would on schedule.
Here's what I know. It looks great, and you are happy. And when you are happy, I know it got done right, and oh, by the way, I'm happy.
Bill, Dave, James, Brandon, and the whole crew from Michalis did a great job around the Dockage House.
Besides being great general contractors, Michalis has experts in waterproofing, foundation repair, mold remediation, indoor air quality, emergency fire and flood restoration, and insurance restoration. Spelled M-I-C-H-A-E-L-I-S, pronounced Michalis. Call 844-FIX-INDY or MichalisCorp.com.
The Ride with JMV.
New Colts quarterback Matt Ryan joins us. Your contract is for 2 years. Are you for sure in and you feel as if you can give this team 2 years, if not more?
I say if not more. I feel like I'm in a great spot coming in fresh and ready to go, but I want to play until I'm 40 or past. I'm not great at math, but it's more than 2 years. And so, you know, hopefully we can be productive. It can be a really fun run.
The Ride with JMV.
Weekdays 3 to 6.
On 93.5 and 107.5. The Fan. Have you studied? Can you handle the pressure? Sharpen your pencils. It's time for the Pop Quiz with Kevin and Query. Brought to you by Jiffy Lube, Indiana's favorite oil change since 1985.
Okay, so we've got to get fairly quickly through this because we want to replay Mike DeCourcy, who joined us right off the top of the program. So let's get right to it. Mark Earl's going to join us, right? Yep.
And a four-pack of Indy 11 tickets going nice. Earl's way for Saturday night. Earl, good morning and good luck.
Thank you, thank you. Good morning. Good morning.
Earl, you sound like a fun guy. I wish we had more time with you here. Lakers. Hey, thank you. Lakers allowed 82 points in the first half of their loss to the Mavericks last night. That's the most since they moved to L.A. just prior to the 60-61 season. Where did they play before Los Angeles?
Minneapolis.
Okay.
Okay. Which team scored 83 first half points against the Lakers in 1959? A, the Boston Celtics. B, the New York Knicks. C, the St. Louis Hawks. Or D, the Syracuse Nationals.
Let's go with the St. Louis Hawks.
Okay. Of the four schools in the Final Four this year, Earl, which one has the highest number of previous national titles? That'd be, of course, Duke, Kansas, Carolina, and Villanova.
Has the most national titles coming into this?
Yes.
That would be North Carolina.
Okay.
Nice, Earl. All right.
Earl ain't messing around.
No, he's not. He knows we got to move. 82 years ago today, the Indiana Hoosiers won their first NCAA tournament championship. Who did the Hoosiers beat for the 1940 title? Kentucky.
The Kansas Jayhawks.
Earl. Do you know the score of the game? You seem to know everything else, Earl.
I don't.
If you did, we'd have to check into some things.
60-42, they beat him again. 69-68, 1953. Bobby Leonard's free throws, by the way. Okay, last question. Tiger Woods completed 18 holes at Augusta National yesterday as the Masters gets underway. With Tiger's participation questionable and Phil Mickelson out of this year's field, there are three other multiple Masters winners scheduled to compete next week. Which of the following is not a multiple past Masters champion who will be competing? A, Bubba Watson. B, Jordan Spieth. C, Bernard Langer. And D, Jose Maria
Olafable.
Olafable, thank you.
Bernard Langer.
One more time.
Okay, yeah, what former Masters champion has a first name that is the same as a great basketball player? Bubba Watson, Jordan Spieth, Langer, or the guy whose name I couldn't say?
Jordan Spieth.
Okay. You're playing golf and you're going to like it.
Wait, you mean there's not a Jose Maria or a Bernhard in the NBA Hall of Fame?
That's right.
Really missing out there. Earl, great effort. Minneapolis, Minnesota, that is where the Lakers franchise was located, but where things went off the rails, number two, just for a brief bit, then he got back on. Which team scored 83 first half points against the Lakers in 59? He guessed the St. Louis Hawks.
It was the Celtics.
You blew it!
Carolina, Kansas, and Spieth were correct. He closed out strong. Mike DeCourcy started strong with us this morning. That conversation next.
Golfers, you're invited to make the short trip to experience Antler Point Golf Course in Rushville. Antler Point is under new ownership and just underwent renovations and is ready for you to experience this spring. Weekday specials, senior specials, and affordable weekends, 18 or 9 holes. AntlerPointGolf.com is less than an hour from Indy. You want to play more golf in 2022? Give Antler Point Golf Course in Rushville a swing. You'll be glad you came. AntlerPointGolf.com. That's point with an E. See you soon.
One of the things I love about betting my favorite sports is that I'm always finding new player props or game props that I like. Hey, it's Mark from Kevin and Query. What's cool about FanDuel Sportsbook is you can combine sports prop bets from multiple games and now even multiple sports. It's called Same Game Parlay Plus, and you can only find them on FanDuel Sportsbook. Combine NBA player props you love with your favorite NHL scores for a chance to score an even bigger payout. All right, I've got a Same Game Parlay Plus option for you today. The Pacers take on the Nuggets. I've got Nikola Jokic over 27.5 points and the Nuggets to cover the 9-point spread, plus LaMelo Ball to score over 20 or more points, and the Hornets on the money line against the Knicks. A $10 bet will pay out over $80 right there. If you don't want to build your own Same Game Parlay, check out their popular Same Game Parlay section where you can join the bets other users are jumping on. Earlier this season, over 14,000 customers won a total of $1.1 million during the Bucks-Lakers game. And if you're new to FanDuel, sign up with promo code MARK to get $150 in site credit guaranteed when you place a bet of $5 or more. Make every moment more and download the FanDuel Sportsbook app. Promo code MARK so they know I sent you, M-A-R-C. 21 and over and present in Indiana. First online real money wager only. $10 first deposit required. Bonus issued is non-withdrawable site credit that expires 14 days after receipt. Restrictions apply. See full terms at sportsbook.fanduel.com. Gambling problem? Call 1-800-9-WITH-IT.
The Fed has raised rates.
But there's still time to lock in Golden Oak Lending's low 3.25% rate.
I'm James Hawkins, president of Golden Oak. With home values at all-time highs and our low rates, you can pull more cash out of your home.
Call 317-706-GOLD today.
Golden Oak Lending, cured my blues.
NMLS 114937, 3.25% fixed, 4.361% APR. FHA 15-year mortgage with 20% equity and approved credit.
Indy 11 is back for the 2022 season with the home opener on Saturday, April 2nd at 7. Having you there is what makes our game day so special. So come for the fireworks, smoke bombs, ribbon cannons, and a brand new Indy 11 checkered home kit available for purchase at shop.indy11.com. Be a part of Indy 11's Blue Out Blowout. Get your tickets now. Visit indy11.com or download the Indy 11 app. We'll see you at the mic on Saturday, April 2nd. Brought to you by your Central Indiana Honda dealers.
Denny Smith here for Sundown Gardens. April 1st through 10th in the Garden Center, all container shrubs are 20% off at Sundown Gardens, and that includes Arborvitae. 20% off all container shrubs, including Arborvitae, in the Garden Center. Don't forget, fresh spring flowers are arriving daily at Sundown Gardens, and check out their pansy selection. Sundown Gardens, 186th Street and Spring Mill Road. Look for Sundown Gardens on Facebook and Instagram, too, or visit sundowngardens.com.
Mike Cappell here, serial entrepreneur with words from another happy payroll customer.
What do I love about Patriot Payroll Services? What don't I love about Patriot Payroll Services? It's easy to learn. It's very user-friendly. It's fast, even for a first-time user. It's perfect for our business. It's affordable, and it's been a great experience so far. We have no plans of changing.
Easy to learn, easy to use. Small business software tailored just for you.
Visit us at patriotsoftware.com. Use promo code RADIO and get 2 months of payroll free. That's patriotsoftware.com.
With patriotsoftware.com, accounting and payroll, keep your time and money.
Indianapolis. At GEICO, our employees' careers matter to us.
An inclusive office matters to me.
We hear you, Kelly. GEICO has employee resource groups to bring people from all communities together because diversity matters. Your hopes and dreams matter. Even giving you a little space, your lucky bobblehead matters.
Want to work at GEICO, Randy? He says yes.
When it comes to your career, what matters to you matters to GEICO. We're now hiring claim sales and customer service agents. Apply today at careers.geico.com/Indianapolis and let's get growing.
The Pacers welcome the Denver Nuggets to the Fieldhouse this evening at 6:30 on 93.5 and 107.5 The Fan.
You're listening to Kevin and Querry on 93.5 and 107.5 The Fan.
To start today's show, we had Mike DeCourcy from the Sporting News on to talk about the Final Four. We began with the Blue Bloods and his skepticism on Villanova.
Well, if I could sell you on Villanova after they lose one of their four best players to an Achilles injury, then that would make me like a hell of a salesman, I think. I just can't buy them now. I wouldn't have bought them coming in at full strength, but unfortunately they're not even there. I mean, Justin Moore was an enormous part of what they do. Brian Antoine, who's likely his replacement, was a five-star guy coming out of high school, big-time player, but he's had a career filled with injuries. So I don't know whether he's never really had a breakout game, and now you're asking him to do that on the biggest stage in the sport.
I think the world of Jay Wright. Mike, and you're right. I mean, I get it. But, I think when I look at, and nothing against Bill Self and the Jayhawks, but who are obviously, very talented. If there's a coach in college basketball that could offset some things with adjustments, I do love Jay Wright.
Yeah, the one thing I will say that's in his favor, and it's not in the game's favor, is that I don't know that it was necessarily him or Villanova that forced the South Regional Final to be the way it was, but we got a real problem in the sport that needs to be addressed. The officiating, it's not a question of it being bad. It's a question of it being wrong. We're seeing scores go back down south again in the way that we did in 2013 that led John Adams and the rules committee to change the way the game was being officiated so that we had freedom of movement. Freedom of movement is gone again. We had the lowest scores in the regional finals in decades, and it's been trending that way all through the second half of the season. We at one point had 25 or so teams averaging 80 points a game. By the time we got to the end of the year, it was in single digits. That's something that he could take advantage of. If the game is allowed to be overly physical, I'm not saying that Kansas would necessarily be overwhelmed by that, but it would give Villanova a chance to stay in a game in which it's physically not as it's physically a shade overmatched because of the injuries.
Mike, officiating certainly has been a polarizing topic all season long, but how much Villanova-Houston related do you just chalk that up to? I mean, a Houston team that was, what, 1 of 20 from 3? And Villanova's facing, you know, one of the better defenses out there. Sure, do they toe the line with the physical nature? Yes, but, you know, to me, a lot of that was just both teams, especially Houston, got some open looks. They just couldn't throw it in the ocean.
I don't buy that. Having watched Bob Huggins' defenses at Cincinnati in person for four seasons as I covered them, that's what they do to you. When you're allowed to be that physical, you can't throw it in the ocean because your arms are tied. One of the big reasons Houston was able to get to the Elite Eight was because it was able to play that way. It was the only way they could play and be able to be as successful as they were. They were under-talented because they had so many injuries, somewhat similar to Villanova now. And so they committed to playing a certain style, and it worked in the tournament. And in part because the tournament officiating has been ineffective. It's been improper. I don't know what the exact right word is, but it's not the way basketball should be played. And so when Houston played in games like their Memphis games, where they were a little bit more free flowing, they weren't able to win those games. But they got into the tournament. Oh yeah, you want to foul? Go ahead, we'll let you. And all of a sudden, they're in the Elite Eight.
He's Mike DeCourcy from the Sporting News, again Big Ten Network, and he is off to New Orleans for the Final Four on this Wednesday morning. Given what you said about Villanova, the injury to Justin Moore, are you expecting a Kansas-Duke national title game on Monday?
That's my expectation, yes. Obviously, all four teams there could maybe win one game, but I think only Kansas and Duke can win two. So I would be really stunned if in a field, in this particular quartet, it were anyone other than those two. In the end, for decades, since Indiana listeners will appreciate this, it's been since 1987 that we have had a national champion that did not have a first-round pick, a subsequent first-round pick, whether it was that year or the year later, every single time since 1987. That's a pretty long history. That's basically my entire history of covering the Final Four. And so usually it's a Danny Manning or someone like that, or a Christian Laettner or Grant Hill. Sometimes it's a Josh Hart who goes 26th or whatever. But you have to have those guys. I don't think they're at Villanova, and I don't think they're at Carolina.
Mike, when you look at the job, Mike DeCourcy is our guest, that Hubert Davis has done this year in Carolina, getting hot at the right time. You know, that's a blue blood program, and they handed it over to one of their own, which I applaud. And then I thought about it, and I thought, you know, we've seen other times where coaches in the first year have kind of carried over what was set in stone, and then water kind of found its level. That's not to say that's going to happen with Davis, but have you seen body of work this year to say that this is, in fact, his thumbprint that is on this team and the run they're making?
Yeah, remember, I mean, it wasn't like he was taking over Carolina at its peak. I mean, they had gone 14-19 in the pandemic year. When the tournament went away, they were going away anyway. They were going to have an empty March regardless that year. And then last year, they were an 8 seed that lost easily in the first round to Wisconsin. So he wasn't taking over the program at a peak. There were two things, really. One is keeping the guys engaged when they were really struggling. I mean, they lost to Pitt at home by 9 points. Pitt did not win another game That was in mid-February. Pitt did not win another game the rest of the year, but they beat a Final Four team on their own home court. That was a bad day for the Tar Heels. And then two and a half weeks later, they're winning at Cameron on Mike Krzyzewski's big night. So keeping them engaged, keeping them believing was a big part of it. And then the switch at point guard from Caleb Love to R.J. Davis, changing their responsibilities so that R.J. became the primary ball handler. And that took great advantage of his terrific ability to get into the defense. And that's what won the Duke game. Him getting into the lane, kicking out, lobbing over the top, all those sorts of different plays that become possible when you're able to penetrate the lane. That's what turned around that game, and that's what's turned around their season.
He's Mike DeCourcy from Sporting News and with us here on the Payless Liquors Hotline. Mike, I don't know if you go back to your earlier point for a little bit of reasoning on this, but the Big Ten Conference and the continued lack of deep tournament runs, what do you point to for that?
Well, I think there was somewhat of a misunderstanding about this Big Ten this year. It was not the best league. First of all, anybody that said that was errant. It was never the best league. There wasn't any evidence to say they were the best league. What they had was the best set of individual players. I mean, there was an All-American at Purdue. There was an All-American at Illinois and one at Ohio State and one at Iowa, et cetera. And that was a unique situation relative to the rest of the country that they had so many individual stars. But there wasn't enough support for a lot of those players. Johnny Davis at Wisconsin, by the end of the year, it was just guard him. Don't worry about anybody else. And it worked. And Kofi, part of it was Kofi's fault for not being able to throw out of the post enough. But guard him, let those other guys open, we'll win, and they did. And that became the way that you played a Big Ten team. They did not have a single team on the top two lines, which meant that they were not scheduled, so to speak, to have anybody in the Elite Eight, which they didn't. So they didn't underperform as badly as the Big Ten's detractors want to say. However, the Purdue episode stands as a significant mark against at least Purdue and maybe the league if you want to carry it that far. You can't lose that game. And they missed at the beginning. Their approach as a group to that game was wrong. Carolina had it exactly right. We're way better than these guys. It's a cute story, but we're way better than these guys. We go out, we show it early, they're going to go away. And that's what Carolina did. There was nothing necessarily technically different. It was just, we're way better than them. We play like it, and it'll be over. And that's what Purdue didn't do. In those first 5 to 7 minutes, they let it be a game. And St. Peter said, well, if we can beat Kentucky, we can certainly beat these guys. Let's go do it.
Mike DeCourcy from earlier this morning, of course, Mike down in New Orleans for the Final Four. And Kevin, that's what we talked about, right, with St. Peter's. Those ankle biters, man, you got to shake them loose.
Oh, man, had a chance. I thought late first half, that was an opportunity to potentially stretch things. About 5 or 6 minutes to go in the game, they're up 4. Could not do it either. So we'll monitor Purdue, the transfer portal there. Indiana, decisions on Trace Jackson Davis, Race Thompson. We heard Mike give some thoughts on that as well. We'll see where we're at moving into Final Four weekend. And Butler, any word on Laval Jordan? I think there's been some whispers about a buyout possibly decreasing here coming up. We'll see if that leads to any clarity from Barry Collier on Butler's front. Thank you to Joel Erickson as well. He was at the NFL owners meetings. He was with us earlier in the 9 o'clock hour. If you missed that, Mark will have that up on the podcast. We'll continue to talk more about the owners meetings, look ahead to the Final Four, recap Pacers and Nuggets as well. Enjoy the warm weather. Hopefully not too breezy. Talk